the Pittodrie Trophy Room. And in pride of place here, memories of the greatest years in Aberdeen's history. Alex Ferguson was the manager. The year was 1983, and it was the European Cup Winners' Cup final in Gothenburg. Aberdeen beating Real Madrid, John Hewitt scoring the winning goal. It was a splendid era for clubs from Scotland in European football, but this was an outstanding Aberdeen side under the inspirational captaincy of Willie Miller. But this is not a vintage season for Aberdeen. Jim Leighton, once one of the Don's favourites, now of Hibs, helping knock out his old club in the Tennent Scottish Cup at Pittodrie. And that leaves the Don's European ambitions for next season hanging by a thread. Tonight at Pittodrie again, they meet Hearts. Aberdeen must pick up now in the league, but Hearts also harbour European ambitions of their own. Hello there, a very good evening to you. Aberdeen's Cup exit, yet another blow in a season that started so brightly. But there is still hope. They lie fifth in the table. They need to press on now in pursuit of one of the two available UEFA Cup spots. The only trouble is that Hearts are in the way in fourth spot, and both clubs know that to be sure of the UEFA Cup, they really need to be finishing in third. A lower finish could be enough, but there are no guarantees. Charlie Nicholas is with me once more tonight. Charlie was a feature in the later years of Aberdeen's success, but you feel as though memories of the great years hang just a little heavily around Aberdeen at present. This was the trophy hall in the 1980s. Few clubs in any league in the world could have matched this, all bar one, the work of Alex Ferguson. They had a taste of everything, 10 trophies in all. Now compare that to the 1990s, it's a much more meagre tally. Only two trophies and both of them cups. No sniff in the league so far. And while the Dons have started to struggle, the old firm clubs have new financial muscle. Perhaps inspired by that, the Dons have been suggesting that they are ready to stage a £15 million flotation. Well, is this the way back for Aberdeen, Charlie?
I certainly hope so. It's a city where, you know, we have the oil, which is obviously famous, but there's a lot of wealth in the city. Ian Donald has been in charge for a number of years now. It's been tried before. They tried this situation before. Didn't succeed. It's time to throw it back to the business and get the big oil companies or big businesses in, because we need a strong Aberdeen. Being in a successful Aberdeen as I was, you know how important it is to get Aberdeen back to the top end of the game in Scotland.
All right, Gordon Smith is joining us from Pittodrie tonight. Gordon, do you sense that around Pittodrie they are aware that they are losing touch with the old firm?
Well, I think there's no question of it. They do feel that they've slipped up badly this year. They were getting close. Everyone felt that Aberdeen had come back. I mean, they're the last side to win a trophy in Scotland other than Rangers. And I think people thought that Aberdeen were here to stay. But they've had a couple of bad months, and it's got to be said, and they've slipped back quite some way in the league, and they're not going to challenge again this season. And but it is, I would think, a transitional time for them. Roy Aitken has managed to bring in some players. There's a lot of good young players coming through, and I think he really has to wait for some of them to mature before Aberdeen will again be a force in the game.
But Gordon, what we're confronting with Celtic and Rangers at the present time is the longer-term plan. Do Aberdeen feel they've got to produce a longer-term plan themselves now?
I think they are. The big problem, Paul, is cash, as we know. They've got to try and launch the club, bring in some funds, launch it in the stock market. They've tried that before. They need to try and bring in some money from the city, I think, for the club. But it's very difficult for them because they're not getting the great support that some of the big clubs have. And as soon as they slip behind in the money stakes, it's going to be very, very difficult for them to challenge at that level. So the way ahead, I think, is for them to bring through their own players. And they're managing to do that. There are good young players coming through at the club, but when the money's available to go out and buy others, they have to make sure that they're spending the money wisely and it's the right type of player to bring in to supplement the side.
Can they raise 15 million?
Very difficult. I don't know whether they'll do it. Institutional money they talk about getting in, that's what Hearts are going for. They're not really launching it for the fans to buy, but it's a lot of money to try and bring in. But if they could get that sort of money on board here, then they at least have a chance of being, I would think, being the third force in Scottish football.
Charlie, it's quite an interesting comparison. Gordon mentions Hearts. They've spoken about raising 6 million. Does that sound a more realistic amount of money?
Yeah, if I was Aberdeen, I mean, there's no doubt Ian Donald now would like to go somewhere else. He would like to disappear in a way. He's had his time at Aberdeen and he wants business people to come forward. That's been known for about a year or so now. Now, it's time if we can get, I think if you can seriously raise £5 million, Aberdeen Stadium is paid for. There is no real debt at Aberdeen. They've always been very cautious that way. So, you know, you're throwing £5 million, £6 million at Aberdeen. It's a good platform to raise a good team. As Gordon points out, the youth development system at Aberdeen is working. It's working very well. And they've got a lot of good players there. It's just a matter of getting finance and getting the public to come in and support them again.
But Gordon, is it also fair to suggest that maybe Aberdeen have had to watch, whilst Rangers did it, of course, so brilliantly, Celtic have followed their lead, and now they're seeing the likes of Hearts doing things that maybe the Aberdeen public were expecting of Aberdeen Football Club?
Yeah, I think that's true to say that, Paul. But the thing about it is, Aberdeen looked as if they were there until a couple of months ago. You would have said that they were really on track to become a force in the game. They've had a couple of bad months in terms of results, and people are writing them off. But I think they will be back. I mean, Hearts are a big club too. Hearts have potentially got a bigger support than Aberdeen because of the fact it's a city club in Edinburgh. When they're going well, Hearts can pull in bigger crowds. So that isn't the real issue of it. The fact is that I think that in terms of players, what Aberdeen have to do is supplement the good players they've got with good signings. Jim Jeffries, it's got to be said, has made some excellent signings in terms of bringing in young players. Roy Aitken went more for a continental look. He's brought in three foreign stars, four if you include Ingolson. And to a certain extent, they haven't really all worked out. And that has been the big problem. You have to supplement your good talent that you've got at the club with good signings when you bring them in, when you're spending the money. And in that respect, you know, Windass has been a good sign, although he's not playing tonight, ordering off. So he's brought in one or two good players, but in the main, the foreign players haven't really done the job that was expected of them.
Okay, Gordon, back to you at Pittodrie in due course. Thanks very much for now. Charlie, shall we adjourn the debate about Aberdeen's financial future for the moment, and yep, let's get down to the action over the last few days in the Premier Division and one or two of the other big games. We actually started the weekend action on Thursday night last at Celtic Park. Celtic against Raith Rovers. What did you make of Celtic's performance? A 2-0 victory.
Well, they didn't. We watched this live, obviously, but they didn't play that well. But they kind of beat the offside trap. It's a bit fortunate to get away with the first challenge from Thompson, but does well and steers it in. They didn't play well, but the whole bulk of the problems was De Canio. He was over elaborate at times, but at the same time, he's got tremendous individual ability, and he really, for me, was a match winner last Thursday night, and quite rightly got man of the match. But obviously, that's a good piece of skill and good finish.
Did you feel Celtic were laboured in beating Raith Rovers?
No, I felt they were maybe just, they looked a little bit pressured at times. Cadet, who had a frustrating night, technically not the greatest, but he's a deadly finisher, and this is the one time De Canio gave him an early service, and that's what happens.
26th goal of the season for Kadete. No doubt about his value.
He is a tremendous fit and a very natural finisher, a guy who loves scoring goals. He's one of the main reasons Celtic are still chasing Rangers.
How well can they do that between now and the end of the season?
Well, it's just all about winning. They must simply win every game. They've got 10 games to go, but it's all pushed in now to 8 games. They've got Rangers coming up in about 5 weeks' time. They've got to win every game and pressure Rangers. I still think Rangers have got too much of a gap, and I think Rangers could probably still steal it.
Do Celtic think that too, or do they really believe they
no,
can still
never,
win this
No, as a team, they will never give up. They never give up when they play 90 minutes. It'll be the same all the way in now. They must fight their corner. They will not let loose until, you know, it's just impossible to win.
Mm-hmm. OK, on to Saturday now, the action. Rounded up, we begin at East End Park. Rangers looking to extend the lead once more. Celtic closed it up to 4 points with that victory on Thursday night. Dunfermline against Rangers is the game, and Jerry McNee, the commentator.
Jury starts a run. He's onside. He was played onside by Robertson in the middle. Loudrup's arriving. So too is Murray. Can do it himself here, surely. Yeah. Brilliant goal by Gordon Jury. With 35 minutes gone, Rangers make the breakthrough. Well, they beat the offside trap brilliantly, Jury. He's played well in this game. Well, you can see there was a claim for offside, but in actual fact, Craig Robertson, through the middle, had played him onside. Craig Moore was arriving, so too was Loudrup, but he sidestepped the goalkeeper and finished with style. The Family nil, Rangers 1.
Now it's Jury. It's Albert. Oh, yes! What a fantastic goal by George Albert. It's goal number 11. And has there been a better one than that? Certainly his strike against Celtic was a bit special. But just look at this one. Outside of the foot. Top corner. Absolutely brilliant.
So Ferguson gets it away. It's a good win for Loudrup. Jury starts a run. Dulwich Loudrup getting away there from Den Beeman. He can finish it himself. What a fabulous goal by Loudrup.
Hamilton and fired it way beyond Ian Westwater. Fantastic play. Final whistle sounds. Dunfermline 0, Rangers 3.
Rangers' 20th win in this league campaign. Gordon Smith witnessed that game. It looked a pretty straightforward Rangers victory away from home. Was that the story of the game for you, Gordon?
It was in the end, Paul, but initially Dunfermline did well. It really hinged on the fact that Rangers won the lead just before half-time. They got that goal, and after that, Dunfermline were always chasing it. Dunfermline are a real attacking side, and you know, they score a lot of goals. They didn't score any on Saturday, but they'll always have a go at teams, but one area they are vulnerable is at the back, and they do lose goals, and it's the way they play. And once Rangers go a goal up away from home and can sit in and soak up some pressure and hit on the break, as we saw there in the pictures, then, you know, there's hardly any team can stop them doing that.
Here's the first 35 minutes, Gordon Dury. Gordon, is this a player who we can expect the best part of his season coming up, Dury?
Yeah, absolutely, Paul, because what happened is he's been out for such a long time, out since one of the European games in very early season. So it's like bringing in a new player. He's a fresh player. He's desperate to do well, and he's full of running. So it is a good stage of the season for him to come in, and a very important player last season for Rangers. Scored a lot of goals and already back there getting a goal in his first game.
Now, how about this strike? This man has been producing these all season, Albert. Is that the best, though?
That is actually the best. It's not the most powerful, I wouldn't say, but he controlled the strike really well. He's actually hit across the ball, so he's took it mainly with outside of his left foot, and the curl on it has been absolutely fantastic.
And I suppose this man's got a future in the game, has he?
Yeah.
I just think Laudrup's a world star, Paul. There's no doubt about it. He's one of the best players in world football. We should be very privileged that he's playing Scottish football. Like Di Canio on last Thursday, he opens teams up. He's capable of doing the individual, but this is a brilliant goal. It's a finish. It's fantastic. Once he goes by Craig Robertson, he knows exactly what he's doing there. So he's very, very, I would say, efficient at putting the ball in the net.
Well, no slip-up there. Do you see potential slip-ups, Charlie, between now and the end of the season, Rangers?
I think there is a few potential ones, whether they can come quickly enough for Celtic to enable that. But Dundee United, people have mentioned, Rangers have to face them twice, both home and away. Tricky situation, but you must fancy Rangers in their home games. The away games is obviously potential dangers. Celtic still to play at Celtic Park. So that's a big danger. But Celtic really needs something, I think, within the next two or three games to give them a little bit of hope.
Gordon, nobody's suggesting that Walter Smith thinks it's all over yet, but inevitably the talk is already of the ins and outs for Rangers, maybe into the close season. What's your information about the way he's going to set up his squad for next season?
Well, I think that there's a lot of speculation about making a lot of changes in the new season, and the main thing is about bringing the average age of the team down. Rangers have a lot of players who are the 30 mark beyond that, and the talk is that he's going to make it a younger side. And that is all very well, but the thing is, they have to get into next year in Europe with a set team. You can't make a lot of changes and then expect to go into European football. And then if they win the championship, they'll possibly they've got the playoff matches to play. They don't want to slip up in that round and go out in the very early stages. So they've got to go in from a pretty solid base, I would say. They can't afford to make too many wholesale changes at the start of a new season.
Davey Robertson, we hear, has a contract that's up in the summer. Do you think Walter Smith is working hard to keep him at the club?
I wouldn't see any reason why not. I mean, an excellent player. He's been in terrific form over the last two seasons. It's very, very difficult to find a player with the sort of pace that Robertson's got, the all-action style he's got, and someone who can even chip in the odd goal or two. And he works really well in the formation alongside Alberts and Laudrup. So I think that the Rangers will try desperately to keep him.
OK, thanks for now, Gordon. Just to remind you, we're at Pittodrie tonight. It's Aberdeen against Hearts. Hearts there in good time for this game, very important for them. Led off the coach by Jim Jeffries, their coach. It's beginning to shape up to be a good season for Hearts, but they still have a lot of work to do. And you have to say that you come to a place like Aberdeen on a windy night as well, and you've got to deliver a performance to prove that you're worthy of European football. That's still to come, and when we come back from this short break, the rest of the clubs chasing a place in Europe. Celebrations widespread for England's cricketers. They meet New Zealand once more this Thursday, the start of the third test live from Christchurch. Sky Sports 1 Thursday at 9:30 in the evening. Tonight we're at Pittodrie, live action from the Scottish Premier Division. It's Aberdeen against Hearts. And Charlie Nicholas is with me here in the studio. We hear, Charlie, no Gilles Rousset and no John Robertson. That's the team news for Hearts. We'll expand on that with Davey Proven in just a couple of minutes. Let's review the rest of the weekend's action first, though, shall we? And the race for a place in the UEFA Cup next season. Dundee United in third spot.
Yep.
At home at Tannadice against Hibernian. They'd have been frustrated by this, wouldn't they?
No. Possibly, although Hibs are starting to work hard under Jim Duffy now. I mean, Dundee United are, without doubt, the form team. This is Pat McGinley getting involved in a little tussle in the midfield there. Picks up a yellow card, and I think that's a silly yellow card. He's suddenly putting himself in danger in this game.
As we'll see later, it's going to cost him very dear.
Exactly. So, you know, this game is all about Hibs trying to get something from it. They're in the dogfight at the bottom. And Dundee United, I think this is Zetterlund who hits the post, and I think that was probably the best opportunity they had all afternoon.
One or two near things for Hibernian.
Yeah, this is Harper. He's just re-signed a 2.5-year contract for Hibs. Greg Miller, who has a great chance. A good save from Dykstra. He's been a great buy for Dundee United. This is Pat McGinley, we mentioned daily. It's a clumsy challenge, and the pressure was put on himself by his first booking, and it's on Pettersson. And, you know, the guy, I think, is honestly enough, just took a knock in the shin, and I think he deserves to go.
Well, it has bad ramifications for Pat McGinley. He will now miss the cup tie against Celtic next Monday, and, of course, it'll hurt him even worse because it's his former club, Celtic. Gordon Smith, will they miss McGinley's influence in that cup tie?
I think without question. I mean, if you're going to play against Celtic in a major game, you want all your experienced players, and he normally, you know, gives his all in games anyway, and against your former club, there's always a habit to give that little bit more. And Hibs would probably see it as a good opportunity to get through, put Celtic out. So I think they will miss McGinley. He's always good for the odd goal, and we've seen him score already in the Cup this season. So I think that he will be a player that will be missed.
Charlie suggested that he feels Jim Duffy's getting to grips with the task at Hibernian now.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, he's come in there and it was a terrible start for him, but he didn't seem to get Jim Duffy down at all. Just seemed to stick to his task, decided that he was going to bring in some new players, work on the formation. And what he's saying is that he feels that they're getting a lot more organised. They're not scoring goals, not winning yet, but he thinks that the team, the organisation defensively is beginning to come there. And that's always the basis you've got to start on if you want to try and improve a side.
So Dundee United still comfortably in third spot, but a little frustrated at home. Now on to Tynecastle, Hearts, who we feature tonight in action against Kilmarnock. Did this look a straightforward home win, Charlie?
It did for me. I think Hearts are really starting to improve now, but I just feel they're finding their form and their belief now. And I think early on, you know, you always have a problem with Hearts. You have good corners from McCann in particular. This is Richie, Paul Richie. That's his third of the season, yeah. And they've all been against Kilmarnock, so he obviously enjoys playing Kelly.
Defenders didn't used to do this kind of thing in the opposition box when you were a player.
This kid's done this a few times. He did a few goals last season for Hearts, and he's come back in as a regular again. This is Neil McCann, who sets up Cameron, who by all accounts, Colin Cameron, who has done a tremendous job for Hearts. Here he links up with McCann again, but he just had one of these really off Saturdays. This is McCann's goal, great individual goal. And when that kid can play like that, you know, he really is very tasty.
Well, he had the stage in the cup final, didn't he?
He did it. He's not done it regular enough. He's playing more central now, which I think might just help him improve his game. But this is a wonderful goal, and he has that talent.
How about Kilmarnock's problems, Charlie?
Well, I think they're starting to get worried now because, you know, they're starting to struggle to get goals. Going and playing at home is going to be critical to them, and they just can't afford to play home games and struggle to score goals. So I think it's getting worrying times for Kilmarnock.
Come on, Gordon, cheer up. It's almost your hometown team anyway, isn't it?
Well, it's my hometown team and my old team as well as that. I played 5 years there, but I think that, you know, Kilmarnock, they're the type of team who are quite capable of suddenly turning it around in the space of a couple of weeks, Paul. So I wouldn't put it past them. If they can get a couple of wins in while Raith aren't winning and get a little bit of a cushion, then at least at the very worst they might have to settle for second bottom, which means a playoff. And I think they would, right now, they might even settle for that right now.
How about getting right away from trouble? What have they got to do to
get away from trouble? It's just about being consistent. I mean, there are still one or two teams down there together. Hibs, Motherwell are right there as well, and they're competing with those teams as well. So what they have to do is get a couple of wins back in under their belt. They won at first when Bobby Williamson took over, but they've had a bit of an indifferent time recently, so the confidence must be quite low. So they need to get a result first and foremost in order to turn it around.
All right, another of the strugglers, Motherwell. They were against Aberdeen at Fir Park on Saturday. A 2-2 draw, this one finished. And Billy Dodds, Charlie, getting the opener for Aberdeen with a lot of space in the box there.
Well, he did, but I mean, it's Willie Fulton and John Philibin who clash, and it's just bad, bad defending. And the first half, Motherwell defending so poorly. Here you see them. I mean, it's just a simple shout to get it cleared. And Dodds can't believe his luck. but he does the business and he's buried it again.
21st goal of the season for Billy Dodds. That was an 11-minute opener.
This was a good attack from Muller. This is Alex Burns, who played on the right. He had two good opportunities. That was the best of them early in the match. To get Motherwell level, he should at least hit the target there.
Oh, all right, as we see later, he does have a say in this, but how about this for a calamity?
Well, we mentioned the, you know, the first corner where Aberdeen score. I mean, this borders on the ridiculous.
Brian Martin's the unfortunate
Campbell
player.
Campbell just flicks it, you know, hoping anything can happen. How he's not took the situation, not took responsibility, and Dodds is just, I would even give Dodds up.
It must be so frustrating for a manager who works every day with your players and then it's thrown away like that.
Yeah, and then suddenly you're into the first or the second minute of the second half and Faulkner gives
back
him
in it.
You know, he gives him a real lifeline back into it. And from that point, Motherwell looked as if they were going to go in and get a victory.
Don't think Roy Aitken have been too happy with this Aberdeen defending, do you?
Aberdeen's been doing that all season also. I mean, defensively, Campbell Harry here, who's a very good player, he's dreaming. Ingles has given up the chase. Burns hasn't, and he gets what he deserves. He's punished him.
54 minutes gone, and Aberdeen's lead disappears just like that, and that's how it stayed at two apiece. Well, they'll be grateful for any small mercy like this, Motherwell, won't they?
They were. I mean, this is 15 or so minutes into the second half, but they're really in, up, and they feel as if they can win this.
One other major talking point in this game, Charlie. Yeah. Dean Windass goes off here.
This... Both Windass and Philibin. And I watched this. I've watched this again two or three times, and I think they're really just arguing. Philibin thinks that Windass has elbowed him. I think he's just protecting himself. John Philibin had a little kick out at him. And I don't think they really deserved red cards. I thought it was a booking. Tell him to get on with the game, and that, I think that would have been enough.
It's going to hurt him very badly. That's his third red card of the season, and he now looks like
And when he came off here, Paul, he goes to the tunnel, and then there's another, you know, confusion at the tunnel, and I just thought, you know, he started to lose the plot.
Automatic ban for tonight follows that, Gordon, but the likelihood for Aberdeen that they may lose him for what, in your opinion, how long?
I think it's three or four games he now has to lose, and they have to lose him. And that is a big blow to him. Windass has been playing well for them. As Charlie said there, he got a bit involved. I didn't think it looked too bad myself. I just thought that Philibin overreacted, I think, to the challenge. He thought he was fouled with the elbow of Windass and then had a little kick out at him, and then he had an argument. I didn't think there was enough in it. So I think it's a decision the referee can quite easily just push both players away and tell them to calm down, but he decided to send them off.
He's had his problems throughout the season, though, hasn't he, Charlie?
He has, but... The incident that happened there, Paul, that's the way he jumps with the ball. He doesn't really intentionally go to elbow you. He gets his body up, and he's pretty good at it, it must be said. And I think he just climbed particularly well, and John Philibin just couldn't cope with it. Mm-hmm.
Will Aberdeen cope without him?
I think they'll cope, but they'll not be as effective, I think, up front. I think they've got Booth and Shearer, who are prolific goal scorers, but I think Windass gives them a lot more. He's aggressive, he can play in midfield, so they will miss him. There's no doubt about it.
That's the weekend action then, and it leaves the table looking like this as we go into tonight's game. Rangers with a healthy-looking lead. 7 points clear of Celtic. They've both played the same number of games now. Dundee United looking very comfortable in third. Just to remind you, two definite UEFA Cup spots, so you effectively have to be looking to finish in third or better to be absolutely certain of the UEFA Cup next season. Then it's Hearts and Aberdeen who meet tonight. Dunfermline losing a bit of ground. Hibernian in seventh, far too close to the bottom for comfort still. Motherwell just three off the bottom. Kilmarnock in the playoff spot as we speak, but it's very tight there. And then Raith Rovers begins to look as though they've got an awfully big job on to get out of trouble from there. Crowds beginning to come in here tonight at Pittodrie. Aberdeen against Hearts is our live football tonight from Scotland. The Dons starting in fifth spot, as we saw. Hearts in fourth. They could change places tonight. These young boys hope that that's the case. Make it eight with Sky Sports. Thursday lunchtime, 1 o'clock in the afternoon, Sky Sports 1, the golf action from South Africa. It's the first of 4 days of coverage of the latest event on the European Tour, the Dimension Data Pro-Am. We're at Pittodrie tonight, Scottish Premier League action live. Aberdeen against Hearts. Billy Dodds is a big hero in these parts, top scorer for Aberdeen. The Dons look like potential title challengers until mid-December. Now it's about turning their season around again. The history of meetings between these clubs. 192 down the years. Aberdeen have won 71, and so two Hearts. Very even spread with 50 draws. Here at Pittodrie, 96 meetings. The Dons have won just about a half of them, but Hearts with a good record away from home here. And Davey Provan has the team news.
Yeah, thanks, Paul. Predictably, at this stage in the season, both sides affected by injury, and both Roy Aiken and Jim Jeffries have to go into this one without significant front players. Dean Windass suspended for Aberdeen. Scott Booth will come in his place. And for Hearts, John Robertson still struggling with a groin strain, although Jim Jeffries is hopeful he'll be fit for the match against Dundee United in the Cup next weekend. Let's then have a look at the Aberdeen side first. And it's an Aberdeen team that has a mix of youth and experience, with Stephen Glass, Russell Anderson, Darren Young and David Rowson all starting for Roy Aiken tonight. Glass at just 20, the oldest of the four. Frenchman Tony Kumbwari starts his 19th consecutive game for the Dons. This will be his 28th appearance in total this season. And further forward, Billy Dawes might be entitled to a little disappointment that he's not in Monaco with Scotland tonight. His two goals against Motherwell on Saturday took his total for the season to 22. Looking now to Jim Jeffries' Hearts side. And they come here after a good win over Kilmarnock at Tynecastle on Saturday. But they have to start tonight without former Rennes keeper Gilles Rousset, who has an ankle injury. Under 21 international Roddy McKenzie will take his place. Neil McCann will partner his former Dundee teammate Jim Hamilton up front. And at the back, Pasquale Bruno, the man who spent most of his career in Serie A in Italy, comes in for Dave McPherson. McPherson also the victim of a groin strain. And in Rousset's absence, Stefan Pai provides the French connection for Hearts. The former French Player of the Year starts this one on the bench. Back to you, Paul.
Thanks to Davey Provan. Charlie, your thoughts on the teams there?
Yeah, not a surprise. After the Motherwell game at the weekend, I thought Aberdeen would probably bring Scott Booth back. I think he had a little injury at the weekend in place of Windass. So I'm not surprised by that. But Booth, it was interesting in the newspapers today, has been saying, you know, this is a big chance for him to get someone from England to come and buy him.
All right. Well, let's hope he impresses and uses our cameras to do that. Here's Aberdeen's story so far this season. By mid-October, the Dons were out of the Coca-Cola Cup, but still going well in the league. They came from two down to earn a draw against Rangers.
Hoisting to the third post for Brian Irvin.
Then they beat Raith Rovers by a single goal. Joe Miller provided it. The Dons were knocked out of the UEFA Cup by Brøndby of Denmark. But they returned to form in the league, Dean Windass giving them a 1-0 win at Hibs. Roy Aitken's men found themselves 2-1 down at Dunfermline when Dave Rowson pulled them level. And they went on to take all 3 points through Dean Windass once more. Aberdeen were forced to come from behind again at Hearts, Duncan Shearer equalising. And Windass again to seal the win. With that result, the Dons moved up into second. But the tide was turning by the time they welcomed Celtic to Pittodrie. Defeat at home by Dunfermline, and the Dons slip down to fifth. A trip to Ibrox offered no respite. Eric Bo Anderson putting Rangers ahead, and things only got worse for Aberdeen.
It's McInnes. Well, they're backing off him here. And then comes Laudrup. Surely it's number four.
The Scottish Cup tie against Hibs was decided on penalties. Joe Miller saw his effort saved. And Kevin Harper scored the crucial kick. Aberdeen went out. but they got their first win since mid-December against Kilmarnock. Dean Windus putting them ahead on 20 minutes. He added another just 4 minutes later to end 8 league games without a victory. They seemed to be building on that when they went 2 up at Motherwell. But they had to settle for a draw when Alex Burns completed a home side comeback. Roy Aitken knows his side must regain their early season best if they are still to challenge for a place in Europe. So here's how Aberdeen have done in the league so far. 9 victories, 8 draws, but that awful spell, and they've lost 9 in total. But the goals for and against, perhaps the most revealing statistic, only 38 goals scored and they've conceded 41. Let's hear from the manager, Roy Aitken. He's with Davy Proven.
Roy, we understand you bring Scott Booth in tonight for the suspended Dean Windass. Are you confident he'll be able to give this match his full attention despite all the transfer speculation?
Oh, no problem. You know, since I put Scott on the transfer list about a month ago, he's handled it very well. In fact, it's probably his best spell. He's missed the last couple of games due to a bout of the flu, but he's been training since Thursday. And he's ready for this game, and obviously with Dino being out suspended, that's an ideal opportunity for Scott to come out and show what he's made of.
What is the exact situation at the moment? Have Bolton Wanderers made a bid for him?
Well, I have an inquiry from Bolton Wanderers, and we're close to getting a bid also. I believe Colin Todd will be here at the game tonight, and I'll be looking to speak to him after the match. But he's very interested, and obviously there's 2 or 3 parties to sort out yet.
OK, turning to tonight's match, you've already beaten Hearts twice this season. Are you confident you're in good enough shape to make it 3?
We've had to make 1 or 2 changes. Svetinov got a hamstring injury on Saturday. Obviously, Dino's out also, so there's 2 changes there. But Boothie comes in for Dino and Colin Woodthorpe comes in place of Svetinov. I've also brought in Joe Miller in place of Kiriakov. Kiriakov going to the bench tonight. So there's just 2 or 3 changes there. Fresh legs also from Saturday, so it should be a good game.
A win tonight would take you 3 points closer to Dundee United, who are 8 points ahead at the moment. Realistically, do you feel there's still time to catch them?
I'd like to think that over the period of the next 10 games, 30 points to play for, remember, that we can put a run together starting tonight. And if we can close the gap tonight and then in the future weeks, then we've got a real chance of the European place.
How difficult is it going to be for the players out there tonight? Strong wind blowing around the stadium?
The wind's just got up in the last couple of hours. It will be difficult overhead conditions, but the park's in good condition, and hopefully it'll be a good attacking game of football. We'll definitely have a go at Hearts, and normally, to be fair to them, they're very much an attacking team also, so it should be end-to-end stuff.
We look forward to it, Roy. Thanks.
Thank you.
Tangible reward for the Dons players and for Roy Aitken. If they can win this game tonight, they will replace Hearts in 4th spot. What do you make of the return of Scott Booth? We saw him in the cup tie, didn't we? Were you impressed with him that night?
Well, I was, because as David rightly points out to Roy, you know, the fact that he's put him on the transfer list, and Scott has always been a fella who, when I played, he was a young kid coming through. You know, this lad at 17, 18 looked as if he was going to be a very special player indeed. I think he's had a lot of bad luck with mainly hamstring problems, but he's a natural finisher, and I'm not surprised somebody like Bolton is very interested in him.
Mm-hmm. Why has he not been able to do it this season, do you feel?
Well, I think there's a time where I think when you're at a club, when things are developing, they're changing maybe for more long-term reasons. He's a local producer, he's come through the system, but I just think he's maybe stale now. I don't think the potential has been achieved, and I think if he's going to fulfil it any more in the game, he probably needs to move.
The loss of form by some of these Aberdeen players, Charlie, how individually, when it's the likes of Booth we're talking about, would you put your finger on that and say that's why they went through this terrible spell?
Yes, it is. I mean, we know that Scotland are playing this midweek, and Booth, Dodds, these guys should be really in these squads. I mean, Booth was a regular for a while, a couple of seasons back. Now it's kind of disappeared for him. And the only way that he can get back into the big time arena is to, games like tonight, is to prove his point, score a goal, play well, maybe get a move in the process. This is how important this game is to these guys tonight.
What about this partnership that we're going to see tonight with Dodds?
I think it's a good partnership. Booth is a guy who likes to run in behind you, got a good pace, he likes to sniff out a goal. Dodds is a busy worker. I think they're a good partnership.
And elsewhere in the Aberdeen team, what strikes you about the way they've...
Well, I'm glad they've got Joe Miller, but I like Joe in the wide department. I think he takes on players, commits, and can make chances. And Stephen Glass on the left is a good player also.
Thank you, Charlie. And now to the story of Hearts' season so far. Hearts began their campaign with an opening day win over Kilmarnock at Tynecastle. Paul Ritchie scoring twice in a 3-2 win.
Chances on for Cameron.
It went horribly. terribly wrong 7 days later when they visited Pittodrie, Aberdeen cruising to a 4-0 win. It seemed Hearts were keeping their best for the Coca-Cola Cup. They showed it when they met Celtic in the quarter-final. At Easter Road, the first Edinburgh derby of the season went to the visitors. Colin Cameron put Hearts in front, and John Robertson created a little piece of history.
The chance is on for Robertson, he must score! It's his 25th goal against Hibernian.
Hearts return to Easter Road for the Coca-Cola Cup semi-final.
That goes all the way through to Stuart Callaghan. What a quick tackle that was by Adamczyk, and here's Beckford! He's done it! Substitute Beckford has put Hearts in front.
That win set up a final against Rangers, but Hearts found themselves two down inside the first 35 minutes. Ali McCoist doing the damage. Then on the stroke of half-time, they were thrown a lifeline.
Cameron gets it back in there. Poulton!
Hopes of lifting a first trophy in 34 years were dashed by Paul Gascoigne. Hearts had failed to win one of their previous five league matches when Rangers came to Tynecastle the week before Christmas.
Slow drop! 2-0! Gascoigne's with him. Here's Gascoigne. Yes! 4-1 to Rangers!
A dismal run that had pushed Hearts to seventh in the table. On Boxing Day, John Robertson helped his side to a 3-2 win with his 250th goal for Hearts. That sparked a mini revival. They won four in a row for the first time this season, including a demolition of Hibs 4-0. On Saturday, a comfortable home win over the struggling Kilmarnock. Paul Ritchie opening the scoring on 22 minutes. And Neil McCann making the point safe on 71 to keep Hearts' European ambitions alive. Season maybe hasn't fully sparked to life yet, but Jim Jeffries with everything to play for going into the final third of the campaign. Here's how Hearts have done so far this season. 26 played in the league, 10 victories, 7 draws and 9 defeats. And they've scored 37 goals in that time. At least it's a positive goal difference, unlike Aberdeen's at present. The boss, Jim Jeffries, with Davey Proven.
Jim, both Gilles Rousset and Dave McPherson out of the Hearts side tonight because of injury. How much of a blow is that to you?
Well, it's a blow to, you know, we're just settling down to a settled side and... You know, it was a hard game on Saturday, took a couple of knocks, and but we've got players, hopefully, that can come in. Young McKenzie's been doing ever so well in the reserves. He's in the under-21 squad, and it's going to be a difficult night for him, obviously, for any goalkeeper with the conditions, but we have every confidence in him. And as I say, Bruno's come in, an experienced player for an experienced player, so but it's not changes that we wanted to make, but obviously been forced upon us, so we'll just have to get on with it.
Now, you come into this game tonight 2 points ahead of Aberdeen, but would it be fair to say that you feel you haven't done yourself justice against Roy Aiken's side so far?
Yes, it seemed to be a wee bit of a bogey this year. I think the first game up here, we had just come off a big match with Red Star and suffered a wee reaction, and they beat us really well that day. So the next game was a lot closer. I felt that when we were leading 1-0, we had great chances to make it 2-0. I think we were waiting to win the game. Aberdeen came back and scored 2 goals in a matter of minutes, and that floored us. It was a very tight match. I don't think there's a lot between the teams. They're having a wee sticky spell at the moment. We seem to be getting on a wee run. Difficult match. I think the big thing tonight will be the conditions. It doesn't look the ideal for football out there tonight. And maybe it turned out to be a wee bit of a lottery and be a few mistakes. So just have to get on with it, and hopefully we can come out with the 3 points, because we'll certainly be going for that.
Neil McCann played through the middle for you on Saturday and scored a fabulous goal. Were you surprised at how well he played that role?
Well, we knew he could play there, and you know, at Ibrox the week before, he caused the Rangers defence a bit of problem with his pace and trickery, and we decided, obviously, with John Robertson out on Saturday to leave him up there with Jim Hamilton, who he knows well and played with Dundee through there. And again, he looked very lively and scored a tremendous goal and laid on two or three other good opportunities for a score, but it was a day where we didn't take them and we could have won more comfortably than the scoreline suggests.
OK, Jim, thanks for your time.
Thanks, David.
Hearts starting in fourth spot tonight. They're still in the cup at this stage of the season. They'd have settled for all this at the start of the year, wouldn't they? Sure.
Most certainly. Now that they've got the crowds back, I mean, they've had two cup final appearances. OK, they lost to both, but they're 2 in 6 months. Jim Jeffries is doing a magnificent job there.
What does he bring to the task?
Well, I think he's brought his own organisation. I mean, he's brought in younger players, which I think we touched on in the programme earlier. Some of his signings have been exciting and foreign guys, but the guy who's impressing me most at the moment is Neil McCann, sensational form.
All right, the manager has spoken a little bit about McCann. Maybe you just care to tell us if you think he can be a match winner tonight.
Undoubtedly. This guy, they moved Dassey at Ibrox a fortnight ago, where Jim Jeffries mentioned. They played him more central with John Robertson. And I think it suits him a lot more, Paul, because he's got tremendous pace, but he also got good dribbling ability. And I think he prefers to start central and move out to the wider positions with his pace. He makes an extra yard for himself. And we've seen his goal in the weekend. It was an individual classic. And if that guy gets a ball, you feel that something's going to happen when he gets it. Not just the pace, but the ability, the combination.
Good brain to go with the undoubted dribbling skills.
Yes, I remember when he was younger at Dundee, Jim Duffy had him, and Jim Duffy used to tell him, and he loves entertainers, and Jim used to say to him, look, get the ball and entertain me the same as the public. I don't care, just entertain me, and he's got that ability.
Brave enough?
Yes, I think he's got it. He needs to be more consistent, but with consistency, I think, becomes belief, and he's starting to get it now.
All right, Charlie's identified McCann as a man Aberdeen must keep quiet tonight. Bit of a surprise at the other end of the Hearts selection. No Gilles Rousset tonight.
No, that's right. Young McKenzie, I mean, hasn't really tasted much of the big time at all. But Hearts youth development is promising at the moment. And in the reserve team, they are absolutely cruising the reserve division. And it'll probably be helped by young McKenzie. But Paul Ritchie came through the system for them. So they've got a lot of good young players. And a benefit they've got now is Gary Locke back after long-term injury. So it looks good. You know, a young side and a nice balanced side. And I expect he'll just stand in no problem for Rousset.
It'll be a great thrill for him tonight, won't it, to be
He'll
part
really
of
look forward to it. This is a good challenge for him.
One other thought, Charlie, before we go any further. The Dons have beaten Hearts in both the league matches so far this season. Jim Jeffries tried to play that down, but is that a factor here tonight?
Well, I think it is. I think Jim Jeffries will always look back in a season and say, there's no way that I want to not have a victory against a certain team. And Aberdeen is a difficult place to go. But then Boyd Mid just now, and McCann's in form. So the signs are looking pretty promising for Hearts to get something tonight.
When you come to talk about Europe, is this mentioned in the dressing room before the game?
Yes, I think it will be. You know, I think this is one of those games, especially for Hearts, where I think Hearts say, we can win at Pittodrie, the conference gets a major lift again, we get just a touch behind Dundee United in the challenge. I think more for Hearts European thoughts now than Aberdeen at the moment.
Would you go so far as to say if Aberdeen can't win this game, then Europe becomes a very distant
possibility? I would say if Aberdeen don't win the game tonight, I would say they'll struggle badly to get the third position, yes.
How do you see it going?
I think it'll be an entertaining game. I think both teams' strengths, again, are in attack. Defensively, Aberdeen have been a bit weaker than Hearts. So I think Hearts will be promising. I think they'll go and I think they'll get something from it. But I think it'll be a very exciting game.
Thanks, Charlie. Both sides want to entertain us and they want desperately to score the goals that may take the 3 points tonight. So much at stake. Their European ambitions are put on the line here. And for Aberdeen in particular, a home support that they really have not given much pleasure to. We're looking for a good performance tonight. Little. We are at Pittodrie tonight. It's a rather wet and windy night, but the focus is on who will finish in a European place come the springtime. Aberdeen in fifth, Hearts in fourth, and our match commentators, Gordon Smith and first Rob Hawthorne.
Yes, welcome to Pittodrie. Not surprisingly, everyone's waiting until the very last moment before they leave the facilities bars downstairs. But Gordon and I have braved the weather to come up here. And Gordon, really, the decline of Aberdeen is unfathomable, isn't it, the way it's happened lately?
Yeah, it has been. I mean, no one could have foreseen what was going to happen about 2 months ago. As we saw in the league table there, they were sitting second top. Fully expected them to go on and challenge for that second place along with Celtic at the time. And all of a sudden, they lost heavily to Rangers and then they fell away completely. So it has been a bit of a shock.
Well, the rain has been falling in the build-up to this match. The weather has not been at its kindest. And the players have been out to experience the conditions, and there'll be a stiff wind blowing into the faces.
And ours as well, Rob, but I think I'll put in an addition for that nice cushy job that Charlie Nicholas has got there in the studio. So always nice sitting there in the jacket. We've been frozen in the last few games, and tonight is no exception. Very, very bitter night up here in Aberdeen, and it will make it difficult to play football. I mean, most players hate the wind as it is, and to play in these kind of conditions, I'm certain a lot of them won't be looking forward to it. So, as Roy Aitken mentioned, though, the pitch is in good condition. Let's hope that the ball stays on the ground and we see a bit of football.
Well, for both teams, it's their second match in a matter of just 2 days, and both teams are suffering from the rigours of that. So let's take a look at the two teams that they turn out. And Zvanko Svetanov went off with a hamstring injury in Saturday's draw with Motherwell. So Colin Woodthorpe replaces him for Aberdeen. Joe Miller takes the place of the other Bulgarian, Ilyan Kiryakov. And up front, Dean Windus is suspended after collecting the fourth red card of his 14-month career at Pittodrie. So Scott Booth, who's poised to leave the club, gets a chance to impress his pursuers, who are reported to include the English First Division leaders Bolton.
Yeah, I think Bolton are definitely interested in him, and there's this sort of formation, a typical 4-4-2, Miller and Glass, two real wide men. Glass more of a midfield player, Miller an attacking winger. He'll get down the side. Booth and Dodds, a lively front pairing there. Not a lot of strength in terms of aerial power, though. Dodds and Booth both do score goals with the head, but they will, you know, they're not up against a big Hearts back three, to be honest with you. But both are very, very sharp players and will do a lot of running.
Well, Hearts goalkeeper Gilles Rousset misses a game for the first time this season. He and central defensive linchpin Dave McPherson both took knocks in the weekend win over Kilmarnock. Young Roddy McKenzie takes over in goal, and Pasquale Bruno fills the hole left by McPherson's absence. Neil Poynton plays despite a cold, and there's still no John Robertson. The striker, who needs one more goal for Hearts' league goal-scoring record, has a groin strain.
Well, Hearts have changed recently to playing three at the back again. They've got Weir, Bruno and Ritchie tonight. Bruno's come in from McPherson, who's injured. Locke is back after a long spell of injury. Cameron in the midfield, a good player to look out for. Didn't play too well Saturday. Very good. And the up front, two young players they bought from Dundee, Hamilton McCann. Like Aberdeen, a lot of good young players on show, but the difference with the Hearts was they went out and bought theirs in terms of Cameron, Hamilton, McCann and Weir.
And tonight's match referee is Stuart Dougal. Force of the wind has actually dropped in the build-up to kick-off, so both sets of players will be hoping that it at least stays the way it is at the moment. And it's Aberdeen in their red tops and white shorts to kick-off. Hearts in their change strip of yellow tops, almost goalkeeping-like jerseys. And Scottish football has followed a very familiar pattern this season, with the teams falling in behind Rangers and Celtic, but the fact that Rangers won the Coca-Cola Cup is likely to leave the third place open for grabs for Europe, and who knows, should Celtic go on to win the Scottish Cup competition, then fourth place in the division might be good enough for a European place too. Thoughts of Europe for both of these teams. Ingles goes forward for the corner. First corner of the match in the first minute of the game. Kambuare, Ingles' central defensive partner, going forward too. It's Joe Miller restored to the starting lineup after missing the midweek or the weekend draw with Motherwell, who takes it, and Kambuare went up, but the referee saw some pushing in there.
Yeah, it was a decent ball from Miller there, but there was pushing. I think Combari was just pushing into the back of the Hearts defender there, and there's no doubt. I think it was Hamilton who'd come back to mark him, and I think it was the right decision by the referee. But you mentioned about Europe, Robert. I think that Aberdeen, if they're going to have any aspiration of getting that European spot, have to win this game. If Hearts beat them tonight and open up an even bigger gap, and with Dundee United going so well, I think Aberdeen would need to sort of forget European football for next season.
Aberdeen desperate to get back into Europe, if only to correct the impression left by their campaign this season, when they struggled through against Barry Town before their elimination by Bromby. Aston battling away. The ball played forward by Woodthorpe. This is Russell Anderson, whose performances have drawn a lot of praise from his manager, Roy Aitken, who clearly sees his job as nurturing a lot of the young talent and bringing it through. This is Miller. And Miller thought that he'd been brought to ground by Hamilton, but no free kick awarded. Looking for Cameron with the ball. But it's Anderson here attempting to hold him off. Just 18 years of age, but he's shown great composure and maturity since his promotion to the senior team. Former youth team captain, Russell Anderson. The natives have been a little restless with Aberdeen's form of late, but they forget the state the side was in when Roy Aitken took them over, and his first priority was to avoid relegation that year, which they did via the playoffs. Last year he took them to third place in a Coca-Cola Cup success, and that raised the level of expectations, really.
Yeah, it was a good run for them. I'm just looking at the formation just now, Rob. I think Aberdeen looked to me, I'll check it later and when the play sort of settles down, it looks as if they're playing with three centre-backs. They've pulled Woodthorpe right into a centre-back position, put Glass in at the wide left-back area there, the wing-back area, and on the other side, young Anderson's there too.
Challenge in the end, having to hold off Steve Fulton just as he threatened to make a breakthrough. And challenge by Salvatore punished.
Yeah, I think it was just a late challenge. We tracked him down there. Or Salvatore it was, sorry. But I think they are playing the sweeper system. It's allowed them to push Joe Miller out as an out-and-out left winger rather than the right where he normally plays.
Miller. Bounced over the top of Young's head. Glass, who's got a useful left foot. Skidding along the ground to Roddy McKenzie.
Yeah, he normally does hit them well, but didn't catch someone at all. It almost broke it, fortunately, for Billy Dodger. He was looking for a little break to get on top of the keeper.
It's Comboire. And David Weir just watches it go out of play. Just 2 points separating the two teams. Aberdeen could move above Hearts. But it's a sign of the way things have gone that Jim Jeffries' team find themselves 27 points behind the leaders Rangers and 17 clear of the bottom club Wraith. McCann trying to force his way through! Well, he showed great determination in this central striking role that he's been given. Scored that spectacular goal at the weekend and was looking to add to it here.
Yeah, he's very sharp, he's quick. Good left foot as well. Look at the control he's got running through there. It almost went across Anderson and caught out by it there. But look at the young fullback there. Comes in to cut it off, but the ball was running across him. But I think it's a little touch and just makes the ball from McCann just slice off his foot and wide.
Cleared by Ritchie. And Hamilton and McCann. At least as McCann switches roles, he finds himself in familiar company with Hamilton. The pair were together at Dundee. Dodds claiming the foul against Bruno.
Yeah, I think without question, Bruno put an arm out and just tail Billy Dodds off. Watch this as he's running through here. Just the arm, the experienced player, he's not going to be bothered with a run. Look at that, pushing the chest, away he goes. But there's no doubt about it, Roy Aitken was a bit concerned about this Hearts front too, because he's picking up man for man at the back with the Ingles and Woodthorpe marking, and he's allowed Comboire to be a free player. So it's not the usual system that Aberdeen have been playing of late, but it's obviously to try and shore up the defence, which has been leaking a few goals.
Roy Aitken's team faced Hamilton and McCann in that Coca-Cola Cup final a couple of seasons ago. And Aberdeen came out on top that day. McCann has more familiarly operated in a a roll on the left-hand side. And it was from that roll that he turned in a man-of-the-match performance in this season's Coca-Cola Cup final, only to finish on the losing side.
I think that's going to be a bit of a battle today. Dodds and Bruno there already had words with each other and been involved in it, so that's one to look out for, that duel.
Here's Weir with the free kick. Cleared as far as Fulton. Poynton. And Young not getting it clear. It's Fulton to Poynton again. Back to Salvatore. Hearts patient in their approach play, and Poynton, is he going to break for him? Well, it took a crucial challenge from the free man Comboire to come across and read the danger. Just as Poynton seemed to have escaped Anderson, that was a nasty challenge, and it's going to produce the first card of the game for John Ingles.
Yeah, it was a bit of a reckless challenge. I mean, he wasn't getting the ball. Cameron was just shepherding it over the line and decided just to follow through. So, you know, a bad tackle, I think. And not always what the results in a booking, but the referee's just setting his seal in this game immediately.
Poynton's free kick. And Ingles let it go. And Weir jostling away with Joe Miller.
Yeah, it's been a bit of a niggly game so far. You see here the ball that obviously totally misjudged by the wind, and the two of them are going at it, six and a half a dozen. Little Joe Miller, I think, is the benefit because he's about a foot shorter than David Weir, I think. And Roy Aitken now, being spotted, obviously not happy with that decision, and seems to have accepted it, but not many walks away, hasn't.
Two niggly little challenges that referee Stuart Dougal has had to make his mark about. It's Glass. Bruno. Hearts have had their disciplinary problems this season. Seven players sent off, four of course in the one match, that remarkable game against Rangers. Bruno was the first to go that day. Knocked back by Anderson. This is Darren Young. This is Stephen Glass. Booth looking to hold it up for Young. Here's Anderson. Rasmussen has three waiting, but it's a good challenge from Poynton. Young, Richie across with him. Clearance by Bruno. This is Hamilton. Did well to dig it out. Looked like he'd run into trouble with Rowson. This is Gary Locke. Cameron. He seemed to be blocked by the hand of Comboire. Real breakdown there between Anderson and Miller. Turned away by Bruno for the throw. Miller. Well away from Poynton. It's a tricky cross for the goalkeeper. And for the new man, McKenzie, it was a awkward swerving ball. You're never quite sure on a windy night like this.
Yeah, absolutely. Good work by Joe Miller on the right hand side. Throws in a good ball. That ball could end up anywhere. Keeper kept his eye on it. Good handling.
Hearts have been used to having Rousset as their last line of defence. Since his gaffe in the Scottish Cup final last season, he's been a normally reliable last line of defence for him during this campaign. McKenzie getting his first opportunity this season. Gary Locke. This is Steve Fulton. McCann has support from behind in the form of Neil Poynton. Here's Neil McCann again. Challenge came through from Weir, and Weir becomes the second player to be shown the yellow card.
Yeah, I think it's the tackle from behind. He's swinging through on the player when it's when the ball's in front of the player's legs. Billy Dodds there has his legs taken from him. And I think that, if you're going to book Ingles from the challenge before, then it's perfectly natural to do the same to David Weir. You'll have to be careful now. He's having a really good season, David Weir. Very impressed with him this year in terms of playing at the centre-back or playing in the wide areas. He has at times in the right-back position when he played four at the back. Very, very skillful defender.
So both teams with central defenders on yellow cards. Another challenge, this one from Locke. Gary Locke, who's only recently returned to action having been injured in the Scottish Cup final last season, hurt himself after 7 minutes of that game. No harm done from the free kick though that he conceded.
I think that's the wind again. It's the wind's just caught it there as it's whipped in, kept the ball high and just made it tamely go past for the goal kick. But Joe Miller normally takes him very well, but he is floating about wing to wing. He's obviously got a roving commissioner playing the three set, the four in the midfield, two up front, and Joe Miller's allowed just to drift from wing to wing to try and unsettle the Hearts defence.
Here's Anderson. Ritchie. Yeah, it's coming under pressure from Rowson and knocked forward towards Dodds. Nice layoff from Hamilton. This is McCann. Three bursting into the box. Hamilton, Fulton, and Cameron were all waiting. Clearance by Miller. And it's Weir and Dodds again. Locke unable to collect that return ball from Cameron because he'd been upended.
Yeah. A lot of fouls so far. I mean, a late challenge again there. One benefit Hearts have with having McCann up front is when he makes those little runs into the area, because Aberdeen have got three at the back, there'll always be space in behind fullbacks, and McCann will be able to run in there and get there and then put in good crosses. A terrific cross put in before, well dealt with Aberdeen defence.
It's Locke's free kick, and it's Richie's head. Skimmed off the top of the young defender, who's already scored three goals this season, including one at the weekend against Kilmarnock.
Yeah, he's a home rear player, Richie. Very, very good defender. Not the tallest, only about 5'10", 5'11", but very good in the air and scores goals coming up set pieces. We saw him do on Saturday against Kilmarnock, but normally also a very, very good man-for-man marker.
All three of Richie's goals this season have come against Kilmarnock in the two games against them. Dobbs here with McKenzie having come a long way, but Weir got back first.
Yeah, he took a little bit of a chance, young keeper there. The ball's bounced up, and if it had been delivered over to the far side to Scott Booth, he would have been well out of position, but he got away with it.
McKenzie, who has been part of the Scottish under-21 squad, brought back to Tynecastle from Stenhouse Muir. Free kick against Salvatore. Here's Comboire, using his free roll to get forward and finding Anderson. Over Booth's head, and Weir with a clearing header. This is Stephen Glass. Switching it to Miller. This is Young, and a challenge from Cameron. Hard-working player, Colin Cameron. Trying to turn it in, but it was Salvatore in the way. This is Locke. Weir picking out Cameron. And they're just left behind Hamilton. Jim Jeffries brought Colin Cameron in from Raith. He's been involved in a little bit of transfer movement this season, brought Hamilton in back in December and has been rewarded with 5 goals from the former Dundee man.
Yeah, they're all young players he's brought in that he signed. The Weir there we're looking at, brought in Hamilton, McCann and Cameron, as you mentioned, from Raith Rovers, played in that successful team under Jimmy Nicol. And the thing about it is that he's a player that will get forward as well. He can score goals, he can play in wide areas, he can play up front as he has done before, and he will score goals from midfield positions.
Dodds, as ever, in the thick of it. Comboire. Shaped up for the header, but it was off the mark.
Yeah, too much on it. If you look at it here, he's got on the forehead on it, really, when he just wants to be glancing at with his temple. When you're coming in from that sort of angle, all you can do really is get a little glance on it and you have more chance of scoring. But maybe the eyes were shut there. It's not an easy one to take.
Aberdeen have had the upper hand in the previous two meetings of the sides this season. 4-0, they beat Hearts here, and the memory of that really stings as far as Hearts are concerned, and it's that performance in particular that they want to avenge tonight, although they did lose 2-1 in the recent return meeting at Tynecastle. Burst on here for Joe Miller. Gary Locke sticking to his guns, sticking to Miller. Glass. Stephen Glass just taking it out too far.
Yeah, you know, a young player that's been out injured, Stephen Glass, and come back in the side now and grabbing his place again. Played excellently when he came in at first into the side, really established himself as one of the good talents in Scottish football, and it's good to see him getting back to form.
Paul Ritchie. And Russell Anderson, who only made his debut against Dunfermline last month, but has played the last 5 games in succession, takes the throw. Good work from Anderson. And a clearance by Bruno. John Ingles and Ritchie underneath it, given away by Rouse and De Salvatore. Comboire. This is Booth. Comboire has stayed forward in the attack, just waiting at the edge of the area now. And Miller looked to make the opening for himself, and with the number of options that he had on, perhaps in retrospect you'll think he was being a little greedy.
Yeah, I think he was too far in though to eventually knock a cross in there, that sort of range. Maybe it had a little short ball into somebody's feet, maybe in the ball and then try and get the return. But he decided, I think, once he'd opened up the goals for himself to have a shot. Normally does well from those sort of situations, Joe Miller.
A word with Salvatore. Here's Comboire. Play from Miller. Good play too defensively from Weir. This is Locke. Go! whiff of crisis about Pittodrie with the sort of recent run that they've had. Just one of their last 12 matches in all competitions has produced a win, and that talk was increased at the weekend when Roy Aitken's side saw that 2-0 lead slip against Motherwell. On the basis of their first 45 minutes, I thought the crisis was over. They were very disappointed about the manner in which they conceded the two second half goals, and the free kick from Locke looking to cause problems, knocked back in by Poynton and then lifted over the bar by Weir, who's a useful presence in the opposing penalty area.
Yeah, he is, and so is Poynton actually. It's a ploy used often by Hearts. Probably didn't want to get as much height on the ball as that, but you'll see a lot of diagonal balls played from set pieces for Poynton to come up. He is good near, didn't get the header he wanted to there, and the first time strike by Weir just over the bar, he snatched it a little bit, but watch Poynton coming around the back here. Look at the height he climbs there, and knocked back for Weir to blast over. Test for either keeper yet, Rob. Nothing of any note for any keeper to do. So, you know, all the play has been sort of stifled in the midfield so far.
Neither goalkeeper really has been first choice for their respective clubs. Michael Watt on the ball now. He's only come in the last few matches, with Nicky Walker having a hand injury. First five matches of the season. In fact, the first one he missed was Hart's previous visit here. Now Dodds on the chase, and McKenzie going to judge things.
It wasn't a good clearance in the end, but it was good goalkeeping. He was well out his goals, playing the sweeper role there, exactly in the right place at the right time.
On by Miller. Anderson. This is Ingalls. Kombouare. Number seven, Miller. To Darren Young. Miller has Booth calling for it on the far side. Cleared by Locke. To concede the corner.
Yeah, take no chances. But just looking at Joe Miller just before that, looks like he's very, very anxious to take a big part in this game, get on the ball, make others play, go and looking for the ball all the time, and create something for Aberdeen.
Corner hit in towards Ingalls, but it's Weir who gets it away. There's Rowson. Dodds. Richie sticking to him. Ingalls coming back well. This is McCann. Great ball from Miller. Booth. This is Rowson. Good hit from Glass, better one that time.
Yes, that's an excellent drive, a lot of power in it this time. Always going across the keeper, not giving him a lot of trouble, but I think there's a slight wind at the back from that side, and I think it's, you know, Glass is quite right with the sort of power he's got in his shot to really have a go from there.
In for the free kick. Again, Weir has gone forward from the back, but it was beyond him. Came off Locke to Booth. Scott Booth wins the throw. Rare opportunity for him tonight in the Aberdeen first team. And it's an all-international front line for Aberdeen, with Booth having been captain, Billy Dobbs too, of course, in that ill-fated match against Estonia in Tallinn. He'll perhaps be a little disappointed, as are most of us, that we're not in Monte Carlo at the moment.
Nice to be there. It's obviously a lot warmer than here, but I turned down the chance of going there tonight to do this game. Do you know how kind of you? How magnanimous.
Challenged by Salvatore. It's an Aberdeen throw. Billy Dobbs. To wait a little longer in the box as Weir clears and McCann to chase. This time it's Watt acting as the sweeper. McCann to Salvatore. Fulton. This is Neil Poynton. Again, Poynton looking for Hamilton. He just could not give Woodthorpe the slip.
It was a nice little turn, though. It was good ability controlling the ball at the back post. A long, deep cross from Poynton after it was laid back. And it came back to the back post here. Watch Hamilton just peels away. Good little first touch. Missed the ball initially there, and then that nice little turn, just too much, just too near the line. Wasn't a good goal scorer, Hamilton. Dundee with a lot of goals there, and since his move to Hearts, has been getting goals as well. But just look at the Aberdeen setup with the sweep, it's given them that little bit of assurance for the ball over the top. I've seen games recently and they've been caught out with a long ball, playing a bit square at the back. Combrari and Ingles too close together, and because of the way they're playing out, Combrari is actually dropping off, so it means that the ball's over the top. He should be there to actually pick them up and not having to rely on the keeper coming out too far.
Combrari, who's been a fixture really in the team since his arrival from the Swiss club Sion, he's just missed one league match. Poynton. With it. This is Fulton. There's been a lot of transfer speculation lately about Scott Booth, and he has the perfect chance to impress Colin Todd tonight. The Bolton manager here to see him firsthand. Salvatore. Dobbs. Billy Dobbs is offside. I have to say, just on the point of Bolton, it's Booth was to go there, it'd be difficult to see him displacing Blake and McGinley, who've been such a prolific partnership for them this season.
Yeah, I think maybe with the run-in at the end of the league campaign, maybe he just wants a bit of competition for places. Never know when one might get injured, and if he did lose one of your main strikers and your campaign for promotion was blown on that fact, then you know you'd be criticised as a manager, and it wouldn't be any good enough cover flag. So I think that's probably why they're looking for another striker, just to add a player to the squad that can be used in special circumstances.
Here's Booth.
Yeah, he didn't get his foot round it at all. What you're trying to do there is get the instep. You've got to get a bit of a curl on it. Maybe the wind didn't help there at all, but he wasn't actually past point. You've actually got to get a little touch, so at least the ball is going past the defender before you swing it round. And he didn't seem to put himself in the right position to make that cross, the young player.
So with a lot of confidence, one of the four players 20 or under in the starting lineup. Booth getting the flick on. Poynton not dealing with it the first time, but doing so the second. Great work from Poynton on the ground. He knew he had to make that clearance, and he did. And it set Hearts going up the other end with Cameron. McCann and Hamilton up two. Here's McCann. Neil McCann! An exciting break from Hearts.
That was a good break. Cameron was in behind the midfield there. He's a free man in that midfield area there. Took it inside, then released it. I think that was when it was on for Neil McCann to have a strike. I think he took one touch too many once he'd opened up the goals for himself.
McCann's second league goal of the season he got against Kilmarnock at the weekend. Here come Hearts again with Cameron. Ingalls, oh, it almost fell to Salvatore, who wouldn't have needed a second invitation. And Ingalls is giving it away again. This is Locke. Save! Save! Oh, one or two signs of the edginess at the back there for Aberdeen. Jim Jeffries thinks his team should have capitalised on it.
Yeah, I know how he feels about that, because it was a great opportunity. I think that the thing was that Neil McCann, once he cut inside the first player, he'd opened everything up for himself. He was in almost a similar position he scored from on Saturday, where he could have curled it to the back post, but that little touch just put him off, then he snatched it and knocked it wide. But it was interesting to see Cameron. He's the one player who's getting in behind the Aberdeen midfield, because they've got three against two in that area, because Joe Miller is not playing as a midfield player for Aberdeen. He's floating about up front, and it means that it's allowed Cameron basically to be the free player, get in the space. You'll see when Hearts are attacking, he's always the first player to go out of the attack, out the midfield on the break.
Anderson. This is Rousey. Comboire. It was quickly taken, headed away by Locke. Rousey and Miller got in each other's way. Salvatore, and now Cameron, two up against two, with two more Aberdeen players tracking back. It's McCann. Good save. It was on the target, that from McCann. He did all that he really could, because Aberdeen had got four players back there. The only support he got was from Cameron. Good save.
Yeah, again, it was Cameron there. First away from the pass from Salvatore. Cuts inside, does well here. Look at the little crossover run from McCann. That's a good run, getting himself free. A lot of power in the shot there, and a good touch away by Watt.
Well, that was flying into the top of the net until Watt's intervention. And it's Colin Cameron with a corner. Of players obstructed Watt's view, also fouled him.
Yeah, it was a good deep corner as well. Look at that, culling right in at the back post there. I'm not sure that's a foul or not, but I think the keeper usually gets the benefit of the doubt. Seemed to miss that, Michael Watt. I'm not sure exactly if there was a nudge there at all with the Hearts players coming in.
McCann has had Hearts' two best efforts. Score with 8 minutes to go to half time. Booth collecting it from Miller. Blocked by Weir. Joe Miller with the throw. Yeah. The tricky little customer is McCann. Had the best efforts of the match so far for Hearts.
It's a bit bitty at the moment, Rob. There's a lot of mistakes being made in that midfield area, not the fluency in the other side in terms of the passing and the movement.
And the frustration was written all over Roy Aitken's face. Poynton. Ombouare taking it away from Hamilton. Put back in by Fulton. This is Dodds. Anderson. Now can Aberdeen get more of a rhythm going with Young? This is Woodthorpe. Getting away by Bruno to Hamilton. Having stumbled, McCann thought he saw an opportunity. It was dealt with well, controlled well by Ombouare.
Yeah, it was lovely skill. He had to be very sure there a slight mistake at all, and McCann would have robbed him of it and then been in and goal. So McCann Barry does take a number of chances, but the thing about it is he's got the ability to do it. Not many players with his composure who play at the back and have that sort of time on the ball and ability to hold it off from a player and make a nice pass.
Throwing in a dangerous position here for Aberdeen. Villa has won another one for them. Cameron's clearance. Here's Ombouare. Young losing out to Salvatore. And the intervention of Neil Poynton. Indoors. Looking to feed it to Glass and succeeding in finding him. A bit more promising this build-up. Glass get the cross in. We're in the way. And don't forget international football coming up this week on Sky Sports 1. The only place you can see England against Italy live, that vital World Cup qualifier. And our coverage on Wednesday starts from 5:30, because before the full international, the under-21 international from Bristol. International attention is focused on tomorrow, but tonight it's the battle for a European club place next season. Hearts fourth, Aberdeen fifth, and Hearts closest to Dundee United, who currently occupy third place but still 6 points behind them, and looking to narrow the gap. Flicked on by Hamilton. rescue the corner. Dots. Salvatore. This is Gary Locke. Keeper Hamilton with the cross. Watt came and then went back to his goal.
Good deep cross from Locke, but I'm not sure whether the wind just added that little bit to it again. Watt came and it was going to be the wrong decision for him, but he was forced. And the fact that for Hamilton it was a very, very difficult ball to deal with, and at best all he could do was stick his foot out and just turn the ball towards goal, and unfortunately for him, over the bar. Poor 10 or 15 minutes here, Robert. There's very little happening in that midfield area. The ball being given away an awful lot. Players aren't controlling it. There doesn't seem to be a lot of vision shown to the players. And certainly, you know, the technique is poor at times as well. But you know, you wonder just if both teams, if it's just getting to them a little bit, the pressure of the game. Is Aberdeen desperate to win this match for their aspirations for European football? And Hearts know as well they can put Aberdeen down a notch if they can beat them too. So it's coming through in the football because it's been pretty poor fare so far.
Both teams also perhaps showing the lethargy of playing two games in a matter of 3 days, although there have been changes to both teams. Both sides have been freshened up. Woodthorpe, who's come into the side for Aberdeen tonight, giving away that corner. He's another player who's currently on the transfer list, like Scott Booth.
It's one of those games that desperately needs a goal just to lift it. Either side scores, then the opposition might lift it as well, and we can see a better game. But at the moment, 0-0, both teams don't look like scoring.
It's Neil McCann's corner, and it's a good header, and it was knocked over.
Sort of lax marking we saw from Aberdeen at the weekend. Look at that, a free header from Hamilton, and then it's the keeper who has to react first and come out to Weir, who almost got a free header in there. Look at Hamilton there, unchallenged, and there's a lot of players round about there. He came off Cumbuari there to get the free header in Weir, and it was Watt who actually had to come off his line and throw himself at it just to put Weir off.
Hamilton who got the first header before Weir knocked it over the top. Is Fulton. Hamilton looking to put Salvatore through. Cumbuare guarding against his run. And the half-time whistle goes. It's stalemate. The fans aren't very pleased. Hearts have had the better openings, and Neil McCann has had two of them. The second one in particular producing a good save from Michael Watt. And then just before half-time from McCann's corner, knocked on by Hamilton, Weir lifted it over the bar with his head. So half-time at Pittodrie, and the breakthrough yet to be made by either side. Aberdeen 0, Hearts 0.
Live football on Wednesday night. England under-21s against Italy under-21s. It's a 5:30 start time Wednesday on Sky Sports 1 in advance of the big one live from Wembley. We're at Pittodrie tonight. Scottish Premier Division, Aberdeen against Hearts. Half-time. And the match facts from this first half. Only 10 attempts on goal and only one on target from both sides combined in that first period. Five corners. Just the one offside as well, and a couple of bookings in the first half. John Ingles of Aberdeen and Dave Weir of Hearts. This will probably sum it up perfectly. An even spread, 50% of possession, but it's a little short on ideas.
Charlie Nicholas is with me. Would either side be too happy with that at half-time?
I think maybe Hearts would be a little bit happier. I think they would be confused, though. I think they would be expecting more from Aberdeen as a home side to attack more. And I think it would Hearts would prefer that because they look better and more adaptable to hit Aberdeen on the break with Cameron and McCann's pace in particular.
Charlie, Aberdeen were looking for some inspiration up the front. It hasn't materialised yet, has it?
I think you said the proper word just a few seconds ago, ideas. They have not shown any great imagination in this game so far tonight. Dodds and Booth have been quite static. They're working hard, but they're static when Aberdeen have the ball 30 to 25 yards out. That's when imagination comes forward. Other than two long-range shots, I think, from Stephen Glass, nothing's materialised.
Let's have a look at the first of these, 26 minutes in. Well, they're playing down the breeze, so it's probably worth a pop, isn't it?
Well, he has got a good, powerful strike in his left foot, which he shows here. I mean, with the wind behind him as an aid. But, there's no movement for him. There's very little to create. He decides to take it upon himself. And I think, that kid is looking for a bit more from his forwards. Mm-hmm.
Conditions a factor here?
Yeah, well, they're not helping the play, but in saying that, I mean, the technical ability of some of the players tonight has not been good.
All right, but Hearts, as you suggested, have played on the counter pretty effectively, haven't they?
Got
a couple of examples.
I think they have. I think Cameron in particular has been running well, but Hamilton and McCann, I think, the combination looks more likely to develop into a goal-scoring opportunity rather than the Aberdeen front. This is Cameron running at the heart. McCann, I think Gordon mentioned he should have struck it then. It was one touch and then hit, and he must hit the target. Mm-hmm.
And another example slightly later on, same thing when Aberdeen were maybe caught up the field just a little bit.
Well, they are. See, they can hit them with the pace. Suddenly it's Cameron
it's a very,
again.
Very well-constructed breakout, isn't it?
It is. It's a good move. McCann does well, but you see, lacking in numbers through the middle again. It's a good shot, but it becomes an easy save for the goalkeeper. He just needs to touch over the bar. But it was a good break again.
Charlie, at the top of the show, we looked at Aberdeen's defensive record this season, and you did suggest that in the past month or two, they've been particularly disappointing in this area. They nearly gifted Hearts an opener right on the stroke of half-time in a set piece.
Well, they did. I mean, I seen them at the weekend again, and they were bad from corners. This is another example. It's a good header from Hamilton. David Weir's unlucky, but it's a marking. Young David Rowson ends up with nobody to mark. And it's just, it's a decent header, but It's really got to hit the target. It must hit the target.
Now, both sides are going to look at half-time and say, how are we going to change this around in the second half?
Well, I think Hearts will be happy. I mean, they really must be thinking, Aberdeen's got to throw more at us. And if that happens, then McCann, Cameron can get maybe more opportunities and goals. But Aberdeen, they've got to get wide. I mean, young Russell Anderson, hardly been forward really yet. And you're looking at Woodthorpe, who's playing the central a little more. He must get forward when he's spare and get a wide position so they can get some ammunition for the forwards.
Thanks, Charlie. Half-time then at Pittodrie, and we're looking for some inspiration, some colour, something a little bit different. Well, the groundsmen obviously are as well, and they're entering into the spirit of it. It's a freezing night, very windy, and maybe the conditions have been a factor in this first half. We need a goal second half, and no doubt Aberdeen and Hearts will be doing their very best to provide one. Second half coming in a moment. Some of the best schoolboy players in Britain are getting ready for the Victory Shield. It starts this week, Wales against England, live from Ninian Park, the first game of the Championship, Thursday at 7 on Sky Sports 1. We're at Pittodrie, Scottish Premier League action here tonight. Aberdeen against Hearts. Stalemate at half-time. We're looking for inspiration. Gordon Smith and Rob Hawthorne.
Well, after Rangers and Celtic, Aberdeen actually have the best scoring record in the Premier Division, along with Dunfermline, having rattled in 38 goals this season. And goals the requirement from both these teams in the second half. It's Hearts kicking to the right in this second period who get the game underway. They're very successful on their travels of late. And looking to extend an unbeaten run. They haven't lost in four away matches. There's a definite sign of edginess here at Pittodrie from the supporters. Many of them remember the glory years of the last decade and quickly want those heights recaptured. But it's a long process. And it's being entrusted in the hands of youngsters like this man, Stephen Glass. Billy Dodds. Batchelor and Harrier is Dodds. Roy Aitken relies a lot on his goals.
Yeah, I think we should draw a veil over that mistake. Mistake he just made there, Rob. I think I've seen that happen to a few players, I think. I might even have done it myself once, but I can't remember.
Pointer looking to whip it in for Cameron. Anderson. Darren Young, another one of these young players brought through.
Yeah, he's established himself well. I mean, he's only 18. That was a difficult one, Fulton there. But, you know, another one of the good young players that Aberdeen are developing here. I think only 18 years of age.
Rouse and Young, Anderson and Glassell pointing the way to the future for Aberdeen. At a time when they don't really have big money to spend. Do have youth available on the bench too, in the form of young Jamie Buchan, which will be a familiar surname up here, and he is indeed the son of Martin Buchan. Rousen. And this is Miller. Richie.
One way of stopping Neil McCann, there's no doubt about that. Knocked on the track there by John Ingles. Heavy challenge, and they end up coming in from behind once again there. And you know, he's taking a bit of a chance considering he's already got a yellow card to be making that sort of challenge, because if you get it wrong, you can be off the field.
Actually off the field when he made the challenge as well. It was right by that touchline, right above the Hearts bench. Given against Dodds. That's incredulous at the decision. Here's Fulton. Salvatore's made a run now, but the route to him was blocked. Still Fulton. Neil Poynton. Was flicked on by Colin Cameron. Challenge from Poynton punished.
Yeah, it was an honest challenge. He didn't quite get it right. He's tried to pull out it, but just tried to block it. Miller did well to hurt him, but you know, the referee, he was going to be under pressure from Salvatore coming in, so the referee did the right thing to give him a free kick. I still think Cameron's a man that Aberdeen have to be careful of, the man to watch out for. As I said before half-time, there's definitely a man up in that midfield area, because Miller is playing more of his now. Is now forward in wide areas. It's a three against two situation, and Cameron all the time is going in behind that Aberdeen midfield, in behind the two. First man to go and support the strikers, and I think if anybody's going to open up Aberdeen tonight, will be him.
The ball struck by Gary Locke, who'd come forward to support the attack just when Hamilton and Cameron, both in the box, were waiting for some service.
Yeah. McCann doing well, just to hold it up, waiting for the run of Locke. Locke was running a long way, it was a 50-55 yard run there, but right away, as soon as he got there, he was always leaning back, and that's always going to take the ball high.
Gary Locke, who only returned for the three games prior to this, after the injury he sustained against Rangers early on in the Scottish Cup final.
Front two have been well policed, Rob. I mean, they really haven't had any service at all to speak of, it's got to be said, but even when they're getting any balls played into that area, that they're just hopeful balls played forward, they're not being able to go and get on the ball, turn to make anything of them at all. The two defenders, Weir and Richie, are in very, very quickly on them.
Good work here from Anderson. Dobbs completely missed his kick. Will it fall for Rowson? Good save. And Anderson looking to follow up. Good save again. Great goalkeeping from McKenzie, the replacement for Rousse. Dobbs denied and Anderson denied by him.
That was a real chance. Anderson did really well here. Cut it back. Billy Dodds is under pressure to hit it, but then the shot from Rousson, this is a good save, look at that. The follow-up there comes in, Anderson probably could have scored, but good defending from Hearts at the end of the day, and a good handling from the keeper.
Yes, Dodds missed his kick, but Rousson really rattled in his effort.
Yes, first real opportunity I've had, first shot on target, I think, from Aberdeen. He didn't hold it, but good follow, and he didn't save the second one, though. I think it was Weir that actually got the second one. It was good in the net from Anderson. A good opportunity, the young fullback, to get his first goal for the club.
There's Rousson. Getting it back from Booth. Aberdeen suddenly playing with more poise and more composure. Bruno with the clearance. This is Comboire. Booth. Between Woodthorpe and Glass, and Locke had little difficulty in getting that one away. Aberdeen have given possession away cheaply at a time when they just seem to be building up some sort of momentum. First time in the game, really, that McKenzie had been given a thorough workout.
It is, and the first lift that Aberdeen had, you can hear the fans right away. You know, sometimes they always talk about fans lifting the players. Sometimes the players on the field have to lift the supporters. They've been very quiet, very muted, the Aberdeen support tonight, because basically they've had nothing to cheer. All of a sudden they got a shot on goal. There's Roy Aitken, you know, trying to get some instructions to his players there, trying to say to keep this momentum going. And the opportunity was there for them to go one up, and you could tell right away, you know, the fans were excited by that, but they haven't been able to capitalise on it.
Fulton. We're under pressure from Dobbs. Well, credit where it's due to the young goalkeeper. Talk about goalkeepers' concentration when they don't have much to do, but he kept his, reacted well when he was needed.
Sign of the frustration that Scott Booth must be feeling here. He's never got himself in this match at all. And if you know, there are prospective clubs watching him, then you know, tonight have gone a long way in order for him to make a bid.
The tussle with Ingles and McCann. McCann's sandwich there by Ingles and Glass. Hey! He's looking for Hamilton. Comboire was up with a clearing header. Dodds against Ritchie. And Miller. This is Anderson. Colin Woodthorpe. He's got glass wide of him. Moves down the middle. Stephen Glass, obstructed by Gary Locke.
There wasn't much in that. I think he knew what he wanted to do. Ferson came across to block it. He was trying to block it already. Glass was on his way quickly. And, you know, it was a different foul. And, you know, not one that would, I think, deserve a card.
There was no card, just a warning or a little word for Locke. Goalkeeper came and lost it. And Booth tried to win it for Ingles. But more by luck than by judgment, Hart's managed to scramble it clear. Dodds. And this time the goalkeeper's handling a bit safer, but under a lot less pressure than he was last time.
Yeah, I was about to say it was terrific goalkeeping, because look at his timing here, is absolutely perfect, but it's just his handling's poor. It comes down on the head of Booth and he loses his way a little bit, but his timing of the of leaving his line for the cross was absolutely spot on.
His kick has come straight back towards him from Rowson, and he was just delaying there, and Miller thought he saw a chance. Bruno's clearance. A much livelier start to the second half by Aberdeen.
Yeah, I think Aberdeen have improved in this second half. There's no doubt about it. They'll begin to take the game more to heart. So, you know, there's always a danger they will be caught in the break a little bit, but you know, the football's been slightly better in terms of getting the ball into the front men and keeping possession, getting it back into midfield areas.
A real difficulty for Aberdeen might come in the fact that the wind, which had dropped prior to kickoff, has actually started to pick up again. But it is Aberdeen who've made most of the running in this second half. They've forced the pace. Blowing in from the North Sea.
Yeah, it has picked up again, and you know, what makes it difficult really when you consider, I think at times there's too many long balls being played, because really if the wind gets up like this, you have to keep the ball down. You've got to make it a short game and play the ball about on the deck.
Miller. And it went away from Locke and from Glass as well. This is David Weir. For Hamilton. Anderson. This is Dodds. Right behind Dodds by Rowson. Pointer. Towards Locke, but conditions like this, it's difficult to judge. He's still fortuitously found Hamilton. Hamilton upended by Darren Young.
Yeah, it's been a game of errors, Robert. Hamilton initially losing the ball, trying to win it back, finally being fouled here as he just takes a little touch away. Young comes in, just catches his foot. Knee follows through in the thigh, but he'll be okay, he's back on his feet. And every chance he might even want to try about a little shot from there. Fulton's on the ball, he's got a good left foot. Hamilton's also a left-footed player, and I think either one of those two will want to have a direct strike.
Plenty of options. Poynton's drifted away. Hamilton who hit it against the wall. Locke now finding Poynton. And he's aiming for the corner and getting it off Joe Miller. This is really where Arts are going to make the presence of people like Richie felt. Weir always goes forward as well. In towards Fulton, cleared by Anderson. Won by Miller. Bruno's missed his kick and given himself a bit of work to do against the harrying of Billy Dodds. Good work from Miller. He's found a way through, but not past Bruno and Salvatore with a cross. Now can Anderson get by this time? Just taking it too far.
Yeah, he was unlucky, but just before that, I mean, Joe Miller did everything right. It's what we've seen tonight. Most of occasions when players get into good areas for crossing the ball, you know, they've either overhit it or they've struck the first player, and you know, haven't seen any decent chances for strikers at all who have been able to attack crosses, get headers on goal, get shots in from volleys close in. Everything, you know, has really come to nothing from wide areas.
And it's exactly level pegging in the previous league meetings between both these sides. Aberdeen 171, Hearts 71. At the moment, we're heading for the 51st draw, unless someone on either side can do something to alter the picture. Locke trying to unlock Aberdeen. And winning the corner.
A bit of frustration on the Hearts bench. I'm sure the Aberdeen bench is exactly the same. Just things aren't coming off at all. All their game plans are probably coming to nothing at the moment. But it looks like it, you know, it could be a mistake and a piece of magic that's going to turn this game about.
Corner. Hamilton was the target and it's led to another corner.
Fuck you.
It's Cameron this time. Made a little too comfortable there for Michael Watt. And now Poynton is to be punished for that challenge on Joe Miller.
Yeah, I don't think there's any question that was coming, because he was almost last man there. You know, it was a desperate tackle. It was one of these challenges that suggests that Neil Poynton didn't want to have to run the whole end of the pitch. He thought he could make the challenge there. Joe Miller slipped him, he was on his way, and he's been brought down, so I don't think Neil Poynton can have any complaints at all about that yellow card.
And they were looking for the offside, and it came, it was Booth.
I'm not sure about that, that is very, very tight. Linesman's flag was up early. I think there was maybe just a little half step there as the defender stepped back that suddenly made it look close, but it was a decent ball in as well. It was a good angle played in for Scott Booth if he'd kept himself onside.
Roy Aitken has said that he will be talking, or hopes to be talking, to Colin Todd about Scott Booth after this game. And Booth is a player who's out of contract this summer, so presumably it's a deal that Aberdeen would like to get done before then.
I think there's changes coming as well. I was watching the Aberdeen subs warming up there, and Roy Aitken is beckoning to have them back, and he's about to have a word with Duncan Shearer, so there's no doubt that striking change coming here. Duncan Shearer going up front, and that will more, I would think that will tend to mean that Aberdeen will throw a few more balls into the dangerous area to try and get the crossing better for Shearer to attack it. He's a penalty box striker.
Lock. cleared in the end by Young to Dodds. This is Miller. Booth is free at the edge of the area calling for it. He opted for Dodds instead.
Yeah, it was a wrong ball from Joe Miller. Dodds had made a good little run, taking defenders with him, and all the extra men were actually in the middle at that point. Joe Miller acknowledges the fact that he chose the wrong pass. I don't know whether Billy Dodds was really looking for it, or he was just making a decoy run. Watch it here. Look at the run Dodds makes there, and the spaces it in front of Joe Miller.
Poynton. Making sure that was his ahead of Anderson. And Ingles, who's already been booked, is in trouble again here for that challenge on Poynton. It looks like it could be the red card. Ingles is being called to the referee for that challenge. It's a second yellow card, and it's the inevitable red to follow.
Yeah, what's a chance you always take here? A bit clumsy as he comes in there, always looking to... A little touch away, and that's what happens. It's a position I don't really think you need to make a challenge. I think you just go and close down there if you're John Ingles, and I feel sorry for him. It wasn't a severe challenge. It wasn't a real deliberate kick at Poynton, but it was just one mistimed. Always a danger when you're sitting on that yellow card from the first half that you make one little mistake. He ran it close over the touchline on McCann before on that occasion in late, and that'll mean that Roy Aitken will have to rethink what changes he's making here.
Salvatore hits the free kick. Well, it was a screamer of a kick.
Good strike. Wind behind, decided to go for it. Always just going away from goal. Michael Watt just making sure. I don't think it was going to be on target. He knew it wasn't going to be on target, but just making sure it wasn't going to sneak in. But Roy Aitken will have to consider now what he does. They had three at the back, so they're going to the four. Obviously, Roy Aitken saying, you know, they'll have to just go to the normal four. That Stephen Glass probably will have to go into a left back area, and they'll have to notch Rowson. I think they're going to put Rowson in at centre back alongside Kombouari, so Wood thought Rowson will be in there.
In the meantime, Stephen Glass has just been shown the yellow card. I think he's been continuing his protest too long over the decision to show Ingles a second yellow and consequently a red, and Glass has needlessly got himself into trouble.
Yeah, to protest. I mean, you see your chances going out the window of winning a match when you have a player sent off. Sometimes it can make you very irate indeed, especially as it probably they'll feel it was for something pretty soft indeed. The tackle from Ingles, it wasn't, you know, a bad challenge. Poynton wasn't going anywhere. It was missed time more than anything else. But, you know, sometimes the referees will give them. And as I said before, if you're sitting on a yellow card, you've got to be doubly careful about any challenge you make.
Hearts will go for the jugular now, and it can go one of two ways for Aberdeen. The togetherness of the 10 men could pull them through, or they could completely lose their heads. But Dodds has won a free kick for that challenge by Ritchie.
Nothing bad in that. Billy Dodds just holds his ground here. Look, Ritchie was, really forgiven for thinking that Dodds was going to actually jump there.
Good work here by Miller. Clearance by Poynton. Kombouari against McCann, who's got tricky feet, but Kombouari's got great composure and great control too. He was very confident in his own abilities there as he ordered his goalkeeper back. Aberdeen had actually been pondering a double substitution just before the sending off. Shearer and Kiriakov were due to come on, so whether their plans have now changed since Ingles' dismissal remains to be seen.
I don't think there'll be much doubt about that, Rob. You have to think twice about changing. Maybe, you know, he felt with the insurance of having the three at the back, they were always going to be able to throw on extra forwards and more attacking style to go and try and win the game. But now, all of a sudden, they're a man short, and they've had to change about. They've got their back to a square back four again, so that must make Roy think twice about what he was actually going to do.
shots make the extra man tell. It's Miller over this free kick for Aberdeen. Richie's clearance. Straight back to Joe Miller as Hart squeeze up. Well, an unhappy end to the 350th career league appearance of John Ingalls with his dismissal. Fulton, cross aim towards Cameron. Conguare with the clearance.
Yeah, did well again, Conguare there. A lot of composure in a tight situation. They're going to have to rely on all his experiences as the game goes on here. They've got the young lad, Anderson, in one side of him and Roush in the other. But they're making the substitutes now. They're taking people off. Scott Booth going off on a night when he was obviously trying to impress Colin Todd, watching manager, and Joe Miller going off. Joe Miller is at least, you know, given a lot tonight. He's always been prominent. He's tried to take the initiative for his team and make things happen. But Dougie Shearer will go on up front, and I imagine, I don't know whether they'll go for actually just to keep the two up front, but I would imagine they would.
Here's Shearer, first touch after coming on. Dodds has made a run into the area, and the foul by Richie, punished with the award of the free kick. Lively introduction for Shearer. The substitute to get his first touch now. It's Kiriakov's free kick. Stephen Glass. Young. The ball was aimed at Dodds and Young took it away.
Yeah, he cut across, he was looking for the pass and took his first touch. He's well named Young, he's a very young looking lad, and you know, he's not had the best of nights tonight, it's got to be said, in that midfield area, but a bit stifled by the experience of Salvatore in there, and Salvatore's done a good job on him, but he's a good young player for the future, there's no doubt about that. But that change, Shearer, you know, is a very, very aggressive player and will definitely be...
Well, Conguare seemed to block McCann's path there.
I think Neil McCann made the most of it. I think that he was definitely blocking his path, but I think Neil McCann ran into him just to make sure it looked bad from the referee's point of view. But Shearer, as I said, a very aggressive player. If they get the right service into him, he will unsettle the Hearts back three.
15 minutes to go. Second match in a row that Aberdeen have been reduced to 10 men. Header away by Weir. Dean Windass was the player sent off on Saturday, John Ingalls tonight. Foul by Hamilton. Shearer's made a bit of a habit of being a super sub, scoring after coming on. Kiriakov, just unable to keep it in play. From the corner, headed away by Poynton, driven by Thorpe, powerfully driven too. Salvatore would have felt the full force of that. Well ushered out by Gary Locke. Favours to either side in the battle to keep up the pressure on Dundee United, who are holding that third spot that looks like providing a passport for Europe next season.
Yeah, Dundee United would be real winners if this finished a draw. I think Roy Aitken at this moment would make, you know, just settle for the draw at the end of the day, considering down to 10 men. But Jim Jeffs, I know, would be very annoyed, I think, if they get the numerical advantage. They don't really make it pay and cash in on it and make their extra man count.
It's ironic, but Aberdeen have actually had the better of it since Ingles went off. The only real chance that Hearts have had was from the free kick, from the challenge that resulted in Ingles' dismissal. And now Cameron is grounded. And the referee obviously isn't too concerned about it, although Aberdeen's goalkeeper Michael Watt is.
I think it was a foul, and I think, you know, it just shows you even the referee can be very close to the situation, and you think you've seen it absolutely perfectly there, and it's only the replay that shows that you know, Cameron took the first touch, and Woodthorpe's touch was into Cameron's leg. So you know, it's, as I say, it's difficult for referees to spot these things at the time, but they're very sporting of Michael Watt just to throw it out of play.
Next live football here on Sky Sports comes up on Wednesday at 5:30. It's England against Italy in the World Cup qualifier, exclusively live on Sky Sports 1, and preceding that, the under-21 match between the same two countries from Bristol. Fulton. Lock. He's away from Young. Weir giving Shearer the runaround and giving the goalkeeper the runaround as well. Well, that really caused a flutter of the heart.
Well, he's trying not to laugh, David Weir. That was a cross on goal and tried to ping it to the back post. Good footwork to begin with, but almost caught Michael Watt out. He's coming out to try and anticipate that cross at the back post, and we see this, it almost just drifts in, caught off his line. He'd have been embarrassed if that got in the net.
More work for the goalkeeper to do from the back pass, and McCann was just there unsettling him. Well, Aberdeen have certainly levelled things up in this second half. Bearing in mind that they barely produced a serious effort on goal during the first 45 minutes.
Yeah, I think Hearts have been disappointing, Rob, as an attacking force in the second half. They really haven't got things going. And, you know, despite the fact even Aberdeen at the moment are down to 10 men, that Hearts really haven't got going through their strikers, haven't created many openings, and the statistics show that. I mean, they've only, still only had the one shot on target in the whole game.
Shearer winning it from Weir. The wind playing all sorts of tricks now. Helped on by Lott, the flag is up against Hamilton. Really will be cursing if they don't go on to win this one.
Yeah, they must see this as an opportunity. More substitutes coming on now, and Hearts look as if they're going to take a bit of a chance now. They're taking off Bruno, and you know, they're taking off a defender, which means they're obviously going to just settle for having four at the back, bringing on McManus. No other, they're going to go for three. That's just quite a difficult decision, a strange one to work out, because Bruno, a very experienced player in the middle, so they've taken off Bruno, and McManus has just fitted on man for man in that position. So all it is a straightforward positional change, not a, it doesn't look like a tactical change at all.
Aberdeen have also made a substitution, a final substitution in fact. They've brought on
young Jamie Buchan. Yeah, the son of Martin Buchan, as you mentioned, you know, a very famous player at this club and at Manchester United as well. I think youngest captain of two cup winning sides, I think, for the Anoraks there.
teasing his way through. Hamilton just wouldn't sit up for him. Poynton, Fulton. And here's Kiriakov. Oh, given away to Poynton. Just content with their 10 men to hang on for a point now. Richie.
I don't think they will be, Rob, considering the way that Hearts are playing. You know, they must see that even with 10 men, they've got a chance. Hearts aren't really causing them a lot of problems.
Kiriakov. Here's Poynton. Looking for Shearer. And Shearer looking for the right-hand corner.
Well, he does employ a shoot from anywhere mentality, Duncan Shearer, and often scores from those sort of angles. It would have been a bad one for the keeper to lose from there. Mind you, it was almost a similar position as McCann shot in the first half. You would not expect a keeper to lose a goal at the near post, but they can always drift in and swing over him and get at the back post. But now Poynton's going off. He's had a decent game. He's had that yellow card, as we know, the foul on Joe Miller. But he's going off, and Gary Mackay's coming in, so he'll play in a more forward position. It looks now as if that Hearts might adopt a 4-4-2 formation.
Poynton, who's gone off, has had a heavy cold, and because he was laid low, missed training yesterday. But Mackay, who's come on to replace him, a great servant of Hearts, holds their league appearances club record. Fulton's free kick, headed away by Buchan. This is Cameron. And now Mackay. Opportunity to make a glittering entrance. This is Kiriakov. Stephen Glass laid off to Dodds. Shearer free. And can he slip it through? Well, it looked for a moment as though it might break for him. Weir and Locke in the end got it away. Turning away from Fulton. Goalkeeper's ball.
I think he'll be happy with his game tonight. I think Roddy McKenzie, he's not made any severe mistakes at all, and his handling's been excellent. I think he's come off his line well at times. He's swept up behind his defenders well. So, I mean, considering we haven't seen much of him at all, looks like a very, very good prospect.
Delighted to have kept a clean sheet if this is the way that it stays. The change now being made by Hearts. Out goes Jim Hamilton. And it's the Frenchman Stefan Pai who's the last substitute to be used by Hearts. Player very experienced, had a spell with Porto and with Bordeaux and with Montpellier. Without Gilles Rousset, Stefan Pai hoping to provide a bit of Gallic flair now. Only 4 minutes though in which to make his mark. Pai. And it's Comboire with a free kick. Thank you. Glass with the free kick. Dodds.
Yeah, it was a decent enough flick from Billy Dodds. Kept it on target, but from that sort of distance, you have very little chance of scoring unless you get a real deft touch on it. And you're actually, you know, you're angling it towards the back post and it might just slip in past the keeper. Once you get any sort of height on it at all, then, you know, you can't be expected to score. But a decent ball in from Stephen Glass.
Richie. Glass. The referee was close to him as it came off his arm. With a free kick. And Kiriakov in the way of it. McCann. No missing around from Dodds or from Kiriakov. He tried to dance his way past Anderson and Kiriakov and Dodds were having none of it.
Yeah, we've shown some nice touches there, Neil McCann, and I don't think Kiriakov enjoyed it that much because it's a bit of a wild challenge here. Watch this, it's a bit of a reckless kick, I think, at McCann.
Here comes McCann's free kick. Lock cleared away to Salvatore. Oh, Mackay got through, but the whistle had already blown.
Yeah,
just found the opening for himself.
Foot up there, I think, no question that. I think that's why the free kick was given.
Glass placing it for Shearer. This is Dodds. And Weir. Fulton. Right time, Gordon, now for your man of the match.
Well, I'm going to choose a man I think will know a lot about champagne, to be honest with you, but the thing about him is I think he stood above the mediocrity of this game and showed a lot of class, and that's Tony Kombouari.
Part of an Aberdeen defence that's held on despite the loss of John Ingalls. Booked twice and given the red card. Aberdeen have hung on so far. Thanks in no small part to this man.
Yeah, I think he's been excellent. I think that, as I said, the first half he showed a lot of lovely touches and very, very composed at the back. He's given nothing away. He's had to adjust to the loss of his partner there, in John Ingalls. And as I say, I think he's risen above the sort of mediocrity of the match. Apart from that moment there when he's just knocked it into the roof of the stand. But there's always the times it's calls for that sort of move from a defender. You've just got to clear your lines.
Ten man Aberdeen then hanging on. Dodds. Glass. And the full-time whistle goes, so a result that really does no favours to the European ambitions of either team. A goalless draw. Jim Jeffrey's side failed to make up any ground on third place Dundee United. Well, a single point, not the sort of ground they would have hoped to make up, bearing in mind that their opponents, Aberdeen, were reduced to 10 men. Roy Aitken saw his side reduced when John Ingalls was sent off for a second bookable offence. The final score, Aberdeen 0, Hearts 0.
And thanks to
Gordon Smith and Rob Hawthorne at Pittodrie. Hearts have the cup to get ready for at the weekend, and Aberdeen have got a few days to rue over what we saw tonight, Charlie.
Well, we didn't see a great deal, did we? I mean, the technical ability on view was pretty zero tonight. I was really disappointed with the imagination. There was very little. Flashes of McCann's pace at times, but no real efforts and goals, no great football at all. Very disappointed by both teams.
Will either side be happy with a point? Something to get out of tonight?
Well, in tonight's performance, I would say they shouldn't be. But both their performances deserve nothing out of this game, to be fair. I mean, I would hate to just jump in a wagon here and say, you know, that's not good enough. But it wasn't good enough at times. There was no entertainment at all in this game tonight. And that's teams who are vying for a European place. If they play like that for the rest of the season, they will be nowhere near Europe.
All right, back to Pittodrie. Davey Provan with the man of the match.
And the man of the match is Tony Kombwari. Tony, a 1-1 draw tonight and a stalemate. Do you feel Aberdeen might have had more out of that one tonight?
Oh, sure, for us it's a big deception because before the game we thought that we'll won this game, but now it's too late, and I think the condition was not very easy for us, but a draw at the end of the match is good for us because we played 10 against 11.
Gary Aberdeen played the last quarter of the match without John Ingles, who was sent off. At that stage, did you feel you had a real chance of winning it?
I thought we did. When they went to the 10 men, I thought we might have had a chance of winning the match, but unfortunately for us, we just couldn't find the goal. But all credit to Aberdeen, they defended well the last 15 minutes and deserved a point.
Good to see you back again. You are blowing a bit. How do you find the pace out there?
It's quite hard. I mean, that's only my fourth game. Still finding the pace of the game quite difficult. But as I say, the more games I can play, the better it is for my fitness. And as I say, I'm getting there.
Tony, just 9 league games left for Aberdeen now. Do you feel you're starting to run out of time in terms of catching Dundee United now?
Honestly, it's quite difficult for us now. But we try to do our best. And I think if we work very hard during the training and during the game, we have a chance to come back, but we need points now. Then to win, to have points, we need win to win all the games now. But I think if we try to work hard, we have many chances to come back, yes.
Okay, Tony, no win bonus for you tonight, but there is a bell of champagne. Gary, will you do the honours?
Okay.
Well done, lads.
Thank you very much.
Thanks to Davey Provan. This is the story of this. 19 attempts on goal, so they did put that right slightly in the second period, and we did at least have 4 shots on target for Aberdeen and 1 for Hearts, the visitors. 10 corners in the game. High foul count, possibly one of the highest of the season, I should think. 26 committed by the away side there. Just 3 offsides in the match. There were a total of 5 bookings, evenly spread, and the one sending off, John Ingles of Aberdeen. Areas in the first half. It was a very even spread there. Wonder what the second half will tell us. Not much change, I'm afraid. I think you would call that an even Steven match in every respect. 8,500 watched it. Here's the league table as it stands in Scotland tonight. Dundee United, it's a good result for them. Hearts stay in fourth, Aberdeen stay in fifth, and there's still a 2-point gap between them. Right, Charlie, let's look for some positives from that. The brief chances that came our way in the second half, first up.
Yeah, well, it looked as if we were going to peter out, but suddenly Aberdeen have a chance. There's a lot of errors involved in this. I think the guys in the commentary says that it's a good save from young McKenzie. I applaud the fact that he saved it, but for me, a good goalkeeper must push that further wide. He pushed it back into the danger area, and Aberdeen, was it Russell Anderson, I think it was, he really should have scored then.
Aberdeen went down to 10 men when John Ingles collected a second yellow card. Here's the first one.
Well, for me, it's a stupid challenge. There's no way he can get that ball. It's shielded well from Cameron, and it's a blatant kick, and he deserves to be punished for that, and the yellow card was right to be given at that stage.
And sure enough, no doubt in your mind about the second one?
Well, I don't think the challenge on the for the sending up, the challenge here, he catches Pointer's left foot, as you see it there. But it was a minute into the second half and Ingles had a kick at McCann from behind again. And I think that worked to the referee's mind, and he thought, next time a heavy slap comes in from Ingles, he's going to go. And he deserved to go in then for me.
Did you see a goal coming in the last quarter of the match?
To be honest,
down to 10
no, to be honest, I didn't. I didn't see Hearts really change, or do change their formation anyway, to say to me they're going to change it and this is going to be an opening for them. And I was really disappointed by Hearts, because lately I thought they'd been playing some really exciting stuff.
Gordon Smith in commentary mentioned the tension, the fact that both these sides are eyeing a UEFA Cup spot.
I wouldn't go with me that. I don't go along with tension tonight. Aberdeen have had a rough ride in the last few months, there's no doubt about that. Hearts are coming back to a bit of form. I think it's one of those games where there should be a little pressure. The only pressure they've got is to try and get in the third position. That's different from the dogfight relegation of trying to win a championship. And that's why there's maybe only 8,500 there tonight.
Mm-hmm. How about Aberdeen's youngsters? There were four under the age of 20 involved in that game tonight.
I would never think about criticising youngsters. I think they gave everything tonight.
It must be hard for them in a situation like this.
The one for me tonight was young Rowson. I thought he probably had one of his poorest games for Aberdeen since he came into the team. But the boy gave everything. And it's got to be the other players who dragged them through that and helped them and put them into positions that can aid them. And I don't think there was enough players, experienced players in view tonight, helping out the younger guys.
Will Jim Jefferies look upon that as an opportunity for Hearts to win a game, put some more daylight between themselves and Aberdeen? Squandered?
Yeah, I think so. I think that was a chance for Hearts tonight to say 3 points behind Dundee United, but suddenly, you know, Hearts are suddenly saying, well, Aberdeen's out of the cup. You've still got the cup to look forward to, but it's important to get into Europe. You can't always concentrate in the cup.
How do Aberdeen pick themselves up now, Charlie? 9 games left, Davey Parton.
I think it's particularly difficult for Aberdeen. You hear the crowd's reaction at half-time. You heard it at the final whistle. They're not happy. The crowds are down. And I think it's going to be a long 9 weeks for Aberdeen.
Have they got what it takes at this stage to mount a challenge now, on the basis of what we've seen?
They have the players and the manager, no problem. I don't think there's any problems there. The club needs to get this share issue up and running. Get the public back behind them again. Because if they don't, the start of next season will be the same as this.
OK, thanks very much, Charlie. We're going to have to go pretty soon, but before we leave you, let's just remind you about a big week of football coming up. The Sky Sports Centre is next up on Sky Sports One as we continue the countdown to Wembley on Wednesday night. Lunchtime on Wednesday, the game day, we set the scene, Sky Sports One, 12:30, with our Wembley countdown. And then the main event of the evening. The under-21 game comes first from Bristol, followed by England against Italy, World Cup qualifier. The only place you can see it live is Sky Sports 1. 5:30, the programme's underway. More live football on Thursday evening at 7. The schoolboys get underway. Victory Shield International Series, Wales against England from Ninian Park. FA Cup weekend in England, the fifth round from the Pulse Stadium, and it's a big Yorkshire derby. Bradford against Sheffield Wednesday. Chris Waddle against his former club, Sunday at 1 o'clock. And Cup football from Scotland for us next Monday evening. Hope we'll see you for this. 7 o'clock start time on Sky Sports 3, and it's probably the tie of the round. Hibernian against Celtic from Easter Road. So we hope very much to have the pleasure of your company for Hibs against Celtic. It's bound to be passionate, isn't it, Charlie?
It'll be a tremendous game, Paul. Really tremendous game that'll be.
OK. Thanks very much for being with us tonight. Sorry we couldn't provide you with any goals. Aberdeen have got plenty to think about, certainly. Hearts are going away to get ready for their Cup weekend. And really the big winners tonight are Dundee United, maybe inching slightly closer to Europe next season. Bye for now.